Are you dealing with a personal injury? Don't go it alone. Turn to the experienced team at Phillips Law Firm. Their attorneys have helped thousands of clients get the compensation they deserve. Call Phillips Law Firm now. Call 1-800-JUSTICE or visit justiceforyou.com.
Needless to say, you don't play favorites, but every family has a natural unspoken hierarchy and always has, at least when it comes to claiming your place in the car. You know how it goes. The one with the longest legs, you're up front. Congratulations. The shortest kid, you're in the way back. And the nicest sibling with the best attitude, right smack dab in the middle. Sorry, buddy. Is it usually the mild-mannered middle child? You bet. They're such a good sport. Is it fair, comfortable, and enjoyable for all? Absolutely not. Until now. Finally, the first ever Lexus TX is a three-row SUV where everybody wins. With intuitive tech, cup holders for all, loads of elbow room, cargo room, and leg room. For everyone, no matter where they sit, this is a new era of three-row luxury. The Lexus TX. Experience amazing at your Lexus dealer.
Hey, this is BJ. Thanks for listening to our show's podcast. If you're a fan of all things geeky, you should check out my other podcast, BJ Shea's Geek Nation. We have new episodes every day, and you can check it out at bjgeeknation.com.
Your home is going into foreclosure, and you feel like a financial wreck. You don't know where to turn for accurate information. I'm bankruptcy attorney Travis Gagné. Let's talk about some legal options. If we work quickly, we can propose a plan to save your home, modify the loan, or in many cases, even eliminate your second mortgage. The consultation is free. I've helped hundreds of people just like you make informed decisions about whether to save their home or exit it on a reasonable, organized timeline. The chapter you choose sets the tone for the next chapter of your life. Please contact me today at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com.
99.9 KISW, the Rock of Seattle. You're going to check out this video on the BJ and Migs page of KISW.com because there's a flight attendant and she's on TikTok and people are digging this because she's saying there's a reason why ginger ale is one of the most popular drinks that you can order on an airplane, which I did not know. I have seen people order ginger ale and I don't know why.
Oh, dude, I'm one of those people. Yeah. There's two drinks. There's two different drinks that I'll go with when I get when I go on an airplane that I never drink outside of being on an airplane.
Oh, I have an idea what one is.
Yeah, okay, well, clearly we know what one is because it's ginger ale.
The other one.
Okay. I think I know it, too.
Is it tomato
juice? Damn right.
Yeah.
Tomato juice, baby.
Oh, yeah.
Those are the two. Is it tomato juice or ginger ale? And I never drink it anywhere else unless it's like a Bloody Mary.
And I've heard that before, though. The tomato juice does actually taste better on planes for most people.
That's why I knew it.
I don't get it, but it's delicious.
And you hear so many people ordering tomato juice, too. Like, just around you on a plane, it's just like, tomato juice? Oh, do you have the spicy tomato juice? Okay, cool.
Right, and I'm not even mixing alcohol with it. No. And sometimes I'm a total savage. I don't even want it with ice.
Oh.
I'm going to have to try it because I usually do like tomato juice, but I didn't realize it tasted better on planes.
Oh, it's a whole different vibe, BJ.
And I thought ginger ale was because people were like sick to their stomach and they were a little worried on a plane. So I figured maybe that's why they're doing it. But
I honestly thought it was because it's readily available and I don't typically have ginger ale in my refrigerator.
Oh.
I'm never like, babe, make sure when you go to Fred Meyer to pick up a case of ginger ale.
Yeah, you're right. That's not something I usually have in my house either.
I mean, obviously, you don't drink a lot of whiskey because that is a great mixer for whiskeys.
Oh, and see, my girlfriend's the opposite of that. She's the same way as BJ thought. We always have ginger ale because when her stomach's upset, that's the only thing that calms it down.
Yeah.
She always buys bottles of ginger ale.
Huh. Yeah. How often is her stomach upset?
All the time.
She lives with Danny.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. I mean, I get sick to my stomach right now, as a matter of fact.
Here we go.
Can I have some ginger ale, please?
Happy Friday.
So, why does ginger ale taste better on an airplane and maybe even tomato juice? Well, this flight attendant tells us why.
Why does ginger ale seem to taste better on the airplane?
It seems like it tastes different because it does. The air inside of an aircraft cabin is about as thin and dry as it is on top of a mountain peak, and our particular beverage service starts above 10,000 feet. When you're on a plane, a ginger ale's extra sweetness may not register on your taste buds, making your ginger drink taste extra dry and extra sharp. It gives off a more sophisticated and refreshing taste. It's one of the few things that tastes better at 10,000 feet.
So the sweetness of the ginger ale doesn't register that high.
Is she just effing with us?
Yeah.
Because she's saying it with such confidence, I believe her. But for all we know, she's just playing a massive goof on all of us. And all the flight attendants are like, yeah, just make something up and put it on TikTok. People will believe it.
Yeah, well, I like her a lot. That's all I got to say. She's an awesome flight attendant. I like her delivery. I like the video.
Okay.
I want to fly whatever airline she's on.
She does link to a travel and leisure article, so she does prove that she is correct. She's not just making stuff up. She does source her stuff.
Wow, that's really fascinating. So ginger ale.
And apparently there's an article about why tomato juice tastes better on a plane as well, and they say it's because of the change in air pressure. And it alters our sense of taste.
Well, that's what she said. Hello.
Yeah.
Hello.
Hello. Are you doing all right there?
Hey.
Hey, I'm BJ Shea.
Hey, I'm Bat. No, I'm not Bat.
No, hey.
Well, you'll carry it. For yesterday it was the equipment. Today it's me. Okay.
Yeah. Hey.
I thought all we right. just got Brother Wheeze in studio. Jeez.
Brother Wheeze. So what they're saying, I'm back. So
are you?
Am I, though?
Or is this AI BJ?
You know what? At this point, I'll be glad to let AI take over. So that's what she said, though. She said that the ginger ale, it's because of the taste buds and because of the... So the same thing with tomato juice, too.
Yeah, it alters the altitude alters your taste buds, and it makes it maybe even taste sweeter.
So the ginger ale is less sweet, and the tomato juice is sweeter.
So that's why I don't enjoy... I just need to go on a plane if I want to enjoy tomato juice.
There you go.
Because I was telling myself, I'm like, why don't I get more tomato juice after I get it on the plane? And now I know not to.
Yeah,
I'm saving myself money today.
Yeah, good job, man. I now I'm going to have more. And I think I am. I always get the Diet Coke, but maybe I should try a little ginger ale.
Well, does the Diet Coke taste better, do you feel?
Well, yeah. Now that you mention it. I wonder if regular Coke would taste less sweet, too.
You know, it's funny when you said, well, you sounded almost like Ronald Reagan.
What?
Well.
Yeah. Yeah, it tastes better, Steve.
You know what really tastes good on planes? Whiskey, especially after like four of them. You want to keep drinking more.
That's fair. Yeah, that's probably also why maybe Bloody Marys are so damn awesome on a plane. I always get, if I'm planning on drinking on a plane, and there's been a few times where BJ and I have been sitting next to each other, and we're like, let's have a couple drinks.
Yeah.
I'm like, I'll get a Bloody Mary, and it tastes delicious.
Yeah, they were good.
Yeah.
You're right, man. They were good. Okay. Well, I have to think about that my next flight.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Well, is this the only register of your voice that is working for you right
I
now?
I guess so. All right. Well, I'm going to, you know what?
It's going to be the sultry BJ Migs show. We should all talk like this morning.
Yeah, I don't think it's going to work for you.
No.
No.
Well, I think I could do it.
You know what? Actually, it is working for you.
I'm feeling pretty good. How about you, Vicky?
I'm feeling pretty good.
Okay, don't do that.
Okay. No, you don't have to go like...
How did you get less sexy? Yeah.
I know, right?
Yeah. I'm feeling really good, Steve.
I was trying to sound like BJ.
That's my daughter's impression of Rubble from Paw Patrol.
Rubble on the double.
Rubble on the double.
Okay, that sounds like Creeper on Paw Patrol. All right, well, there's a man that came up with a creative and illegal way to get out of being under house arrest. And the very sexy Steve will tell you all about it. He's got the Migs report for you at 6:17 on The Rock.
You know it.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW.
It's after bedtime, the kids are asleep, and the moms are out to play.
We're Dina and Kristen, the duo behind the Instagram account Big Little Feelings. I'm Dina, I'm a child therapist and mom of two who nerds out on all things neurobiology and psychology. And Kristen is a parent coach who wrangles three kids on a daily basis, here to give it to us like it is.
We weren't meant to do this parenting thing alone. Consider After Bedtime your village.
Follow After Bedtime with Big Little Feelings on the Odyssey app or wherever you get your podcasts.
99.9 KISW, The Rock of Seattle.
Well informed on the issues of the day?
Nope.
Not this guy. Live from the KISW News Center in downtown Seattle, this is the Migs Report.
Well, thanks, you guys. Thanks to Palace Law for giving us the Migs Report. And today is the day to enjoy using the and symbol. It's National Ampersand Day.
Ah, the old ampersand.
So there you go. Have fun with that. I don't know what you want to do, but maybe instead of spelling out and today, whatever it is that you're sending out, emails, text messages, use that symbol.
Well,
represent.
Does anybody spell out and anymore?
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, you still do, huh?
Yeah. Sometimes it's easier than just looking for that damn symbol. But today, you know what? You got to focus on finding the symbol.
Okay.
Also, today is a very special day for you, BJ.
Okay.
Today
It's National Star Trek Day.
Oh, that's right. Yes.
Is it today the day that it was created or put on TV?
There's a bit of a controversy, because there was a this was the day that the first Star Trek episode ever aired in the United States. I say the United States because Canada pulled a well actually yesterday.
Oh, was it yesterday that it aired in Canada?
Yeah.
Look at Canada.
So Canada pulled a well actually.
Staking their claim.
Yeah.
Shout out to Canada. Also, apparently, did you know? I'm sure you did. But I'm going to ask you. Did you know that Captain Kirk wasn't even in the pilot of the first show?
Of course I did.
Did you also know that Sulu never had a first name?
Well, yeah, you know what? In the TV series, yes, they finally did give him one, yes.
Look at this. I love it. This is awesome.
Yeah.
But my favorite, and I didn't know this until this morning, did you know that there's a disco version of the theme song?
Yes.
And singing that disco version is Uhura, Nichelle Nichols.
I didn't realize she was singing the disco version. I didn't know that.
Oh, I have it. And it's amazing, BJ.
Check it out.
I don't know what the hell she's singing. High fidelity.
Yeah, she had a great voice.
Not a good producer, though. Oh, she's in Star Trek. Here's the best part, though. This puts me in a good mood.
This is really... I don't think I've ever heard this version.
That bass, man, is just bumping.
Yeah. Do it. Oh, don't do it.
No, I don't want to do it.
Don't do it.
How high were they when they wrote and recorded this song?
Yeah, they were pretty high.
Like, Michelle, just sing some stuff. Throw Star Trek in there at some point. We'll make $1 million off of this.
It does... The Star Trek theme does have lyrics.
Okay, are those them?
I don't know if those are them, though, but they do. They do have lyrics. And Nichelle had an amazing voice, which is why I think it's really interesting they went and got a Broadway person, I believe, to Celia Rose Gooding to play her in the new Strange New Worlds. And she also has an amazing voice, which I think is a nice homage to Nichelle.
Well, then she needs to do a new version of the Star Trek disco song.
People are already pissed off at the musical episode that just happened and started recently on Strange New Worlds. And so I don't think anybody wants any more music from Star Trek right now.
Okay, fine.
Yeah.
Fine. They probably didn't do a disco version, and that's why they're upset, BJ.
Yeah.
You know, in space.
Oh, Final Frontier.
We only like disco.
Yeah. You know who's responsible for Star Trek, don't you?
I'm going to go with Bill Gates.
Yeah, Lucille Ball. I love Lucy Lady. If it wasn't for her, there'd be no Star Trek. She was the one that believed in the show. And you said there was a different captain. This was unheard of back in the day. They did a pilot. The pilot was rejected. And Lucille Ball said, no, I want to do this show. And so they commissioned a new pilot. And the dude wasn't available, so they got Shatner.
You're like me at home when I get really excited to tell my wife something about wrestling.
Yeah.
And I'm looking at her and I'm like, why am I doing this? I can tell she doesn't care, but I'm not going to stop because I'm really fired up.
I
appreciate the passion, BJ.
Yeah, I do have it. And Lucille Ball, I think a lot of people don't know, but she was responsible for Star Trek, and she doesn't get a lot of props for that. She really believed in the show way back in the day. So
that is pretty awesome.
Thank you. That is, you know what? R2 also believed in the show.
All right, let's head to Ohio, where a guy was caught on security camera with one of the dumbest, and I have to say, kind of creative ways to get out of being under house arrest. So, like, you know, sometimes you can leave your house as long as you got that ankle bracelet going. So, apparently, he was at a local Ace Hardware store, and while he had his ankle bracelet on, he said, you know what? The best way to get this ankle bracelet off is not to serve your time, but to grab a pair of hedge clippers and clip them off.
That's how you do it.
Here's the store manager, Cheryl, talking about what happened.
Maybe he thought that it was an out-of-the-way spot, that he could just come in, and we have hedge clippers. The other stores in the plaza do not have them. And we were the helpful hardware folks with the hedge clippers. Yes, we were.
And so then he cuts the ankle bracelet off, and then he kind of puts it on one of the shelves. But fortunately, one of the employees noticed that the cut ankle bracelet was on the shelf. And then they called the police, but they have it all on surveillance footage, so it's not going to be hard to find this guy at some point.
Yeah.
So now it's like, okay, we got to just grab this guy and
arrest them and probably put them behind bars as opposed to ankle bracelet arrest.
And I feel like, don't they have some sort of system designed in those things that if somebody cuts it, they know?
Oh, I'm sure they do.
Yeah, I mean, this guy's a genius.
But it's not like that old movie, The Running Man, where you cut it and then your head blows off or whatever it is. I love that he also took some popcorn on the way out.
Oh, so he stole the popcorn.
Well, I think the popcorn's free for customers. You know how they have that popcorn machine, and you can kind of just get scoop yourself. And what they do it at, like Les Schwab has that as well.
Oh, that's awesome! Then I didn't realize they did that.
He just grabbed a bag of popcorn and then left.
Ah, see how you, but you know, you can't resist good popcorn.
So he wasn't stealing that. I don't think they should arrest him for that.
No, it's free.
Although, do you have to buy something?
Oh.
I don't know what the rules are with that. I don't think you do.
I know restrooms are for people that have to buy stuff, but I don't know about the popcorn.
All right, let's talk a little bit about something awesome that happened yesterday, and that's Luis Castillo.
Oh, you want to talk about that, do you?
Mariners and Luis Castillo, they beat the Tampa Bay Rays 1-0. Holy crap. That was a good game against a great team.
Yeah.
It got a little scary in the ninth, I got to say. And Munoz got the save. But I got a little nervous when he hit a batter.
Yeah.
But thankfully, Cal Raleigh threw the guy out when he tried to steal the base. So that was awesome. But we got to talk about the best part about the game. Not that the Mariners won.
Yeah.
But Teoscar Hernandez, his hitting ways continue.
Yeah.
16-game hitting streak. That's a career high for him. He now has a .271 batting average, BJ.
If you told me that
I did.
Cal Raleigh, that Ty France would have a lower batting average than Teoscar Hernandez, I would say you were high.
See, some don't believe in Teoscar Hernandez. This guy did.
I believed in getting free breakfast and thought it was a real easy thing to be able to say that Teoscar's not going to get over.
I hope he knows that we're the reason why he's good.
Yeah. Oh, you know what? I think he really needs to know that because I don't think there's anything else but you believing and me betting against him.
Astros didn't play yesterday, so now we're a half game back of the Houston Astros for first place. And also, I mean, that wild card spot right now at the top of the wild card is the Tampa Bay Rays. So you got to keep beating them. You get closer and closer. You're like, I think we're 5.5 games back of the Rays now for that top spot in the wild card. So trying to solidify,
dude, it's going to be
playoff hopes.
It's going to be insane. I think the last three series are against Texas and Houston.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's going to be nuts.
So good.
The way this baseball season will end for the Mariners. What an exciting time.
How about the last 60 games? The Mariners are 41-19. What a great.
Yeah, you kind of have to do that if you want to be in the playoffs.
Hell yeah. Up next, George Kirby's on the mound taking on the Rays once again. That's going to be happening tonight. I don't know. Did you catch the Marlins-Dodgers game?
No, I know they got destroyed.
They got destroyed 10-0. But the best part, at one point, the Dodgers were up 3-0. And one of the players on the Dodgers, Freddie Freeman,
he hit a
line drive down first base. And it was fair. But the bat boy thought it was foul and then grabbed the ball. The bat boy, it looked like Batman because the guy didn't look like a boy. But he grabbed the ball that is fair and picked it up and threw it into the crowd.
Nice.
Here's the play-by-play of what happened.
Freddie dumps one fair just inside the line on the right field line. Oh, the ball boy thought it was foul. He picked it up and threw it into the stands.
There you go, the ball boy.
Yeah.
That's a big no-no. Do you think he's getting fired for that?
Well,
a lot of people on Twitter are like, oh, man, there's the moment that guy got fired.
The only problem with that is if there was a guy that could have scored from first. Because it's a ground rule double when something like that
happens. Well, no, they got a run from that.
Oh, they did?
Yeah, that was an RBI double.
Oh,
yeah,
hopefully he was on second then. Because, I mean, sometimes when you're on first base, and like sometimes when you hit a ground ball like that, a dude can score all the way from first if he's fast. But if somebody picks it up,
there was a guy on first base. The guy was on first when that hit happened.
So they gave it to him.
Yeah, according to the umpire, they gave it to him. It was umpire's discretion. They said, yep, there, gets the run.
Oh, that is awesome, because normally, back, you know, before they did that, they would just go, sorry, dude, it's like a ground rule double, which means only two bases.
You know, you want to give them a hard time. At the end of the day, the team lost 10-0.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not like this guy. I mean, they were...
Well, you don't fire the guy. He was helping the team. If it was it a home game for the other side?
No, it was the Marlins ball boy.
That's what I'm saying. So the Marlins ball boy stopped the Dodger guy, right? So you'd think that it would have been...
Well, they ended up getting that run, though.
Yeah, they probably... Oh, yeah, you're right.
I guess, I mean, at the end of the day, they probably would have scored that run anyway.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, I mean, if I'm the Marlins, we'd be like, hey, do whatever... Because Freddie Freeman right now is like a really hot hitter, too.
What the hell was the ball boy doing there? I guess he didn't realize it was fair.
Yeah. Yeah.
Was he paying attention or was he just kind of picking his nose, I wonder?
That's like putting me in for now. Is it? Oh, I'm just going to grab it and throw it.
Yeah.
You got to read the room. I mean, if he didn't see a guy running, like, you know, you got to sort of look at the ball players and see, like, wait, is it really foul? Do I have to go get this?
The best part is then looking at the outfielder for the Marlins who's just staring at the guy like, what the F are you doing, man?
Dude, we're losing 10-0. I'm trying to stop more runs from coming in. Leave me alone.
Apparently, this isn't the first time that a Marlins ball boy or bat boy has been in the news. Back in 2005, of course, this weird information comes up on the internet. The Marlins had to suspend their bat boy for 6 games because, well, he took a dare to drink a gallon of milk in less than an hour for $500 from one of the players.
What? Yeah. Oh, but one of the players did it to him.
I guess dared him.
Okay, so one of the players knew that this bat boy was wild.
Oh, man, last night it was Sunday Night Football on a Thursday night because it was on the broadcast with NBC. But anyways, how about the Lions? Big win. The Jared Goff era finally happening after now it's his third season with the team.
And yeah.
I mean, it was a fun game to watch, and they ended up beating the Kansas City Chiefs 21-20 last night. So that was kind of exciting to watch that.
Yeah, a lot of folks aren't giving the Lions any chance, but man, I mean, I don't know how many changes they had, but last year the Lions really finished strong.
Well, they better not have a good second game because that's going to be us.
Oh, no, I don't want that.
Right, we don't want them riding high off of that because, yeah, they're playing us in week 2.
Oh, that's not cool.
And, of course, we've got did you watch any of the game? Chris Collinsworth, before the game, is getting made fun of by everybody on the internet because it's one of those, like, if the men's room is doing their No S Sherlock segment, I feel like this would be one of those moments. He's just talking about all the injuries that the Kansas City Chiefs are dealing with, but also mentioning how, well, they still have Patrick Mahomes, and he had this to say.
Oh, they have no Travis Kelce, no Chris Jones, their second and third best players on this great team. But they have Patrick Mahomes. And I think America is about to find out how good he really is.
Oh, they are?
He's a 2-time NFL MVP. He's a 2-time Super Bowl MVP. Man, it's good that we finally get to notice how good Patrick Mahomes is.
You know, I don't know if you remember, dude, but when we had Luke Wilson on the show, I asked him a question about what actually Chris Collinsworth said about something going on in a Seahawk game.
Uh-huh.
And he's like, that guy is clueless.
It was so great when he said that.
Yeah, he just was not. He was like, Chris Collinsworth doesn't know what the hell's going on.
And he said it with like such like a profound look on his face, like, I've got something to say.
Yeah. Chris, I don't know, man. I don't know if what's going on with him, but it doesn't seem like he's ever played football.
And Chris Jones, that's that player that's not, he's not injured. He's just in the middle of like a contract issue. And some are saying that maybe that it might be a situation where maybe the Seahawks are going to make a play for him. He's a very good defensive player.
Oh, that would be nice.
I don't know if that's going to happen or if he's eventually just going to get paid. Like Joe Burrow, who just got paid.
Yeah, how much is Joe getting?
He's the highest paid now player in the NFL. Just signed a deal, 5-year extension, $275 million, $219 of it guaranteed. I really hope he hits that other $56 million. I don't want him to have to suffer with his bills.
Yeah, you're right.
Car payments and things like that. He had 2 years remaining on his rookie deal, but they were like, let's lock him in. Obviously, damn. I mean, he helped them get to the AFC Championship game last year, helped them go to the Super Bowl the year before. So, I mean, that's someone that they feel is the future, and they're willing to pay him for it and pay him a lot.
Well, we'll see who has a really better, who has a better season because they paid a lot of money and a lot of draft picks for Russell Wilson. We'll see. Over at Denver, so I mean, it's a because I don't know if they play each other this year in the AFC or not, but I mean that's somebody Denver's going to have to go through.
Seahawks at home this weekend, big home opener, 125. They're playing on Sunday against the Los Angeles Rams. You can watch that game on Fox. The Rams without Cooper Kupp, so that's nice to see.
Sure is.
I mean, unless you're a Rams fan, then it's not nice to see. But I don't care about you. tonight you have a couple of opportunities to be members of our show. Both involve getting drunk and yelling.
Woo!
You can either get on over to Numo's, get drunk, and yell some of your favorite emo songs, as Danny V is going to be DJing Emo Night, along with Sarah and also Joe going to be there as well.
Falling off the stage, most likely, but yes, come sing.
And I might be falling off the ring in Tacoma, because tonight you can come on over to SOS Pro Wrestling at Edison Square, and you get drunk and yell at your favorite wrestlers.
Nice.
Watch me as I beat up a monkey, BJ.
What?
Tonight at Edison Square, I have a big match against a monkey.
Is it real? I mean, they can be really tough.
Yeah, look, he's real.
Oh, Mojo, look at this.
Mojo the monkey.
I love his Hawaiian shirt.
Well, you know, he's on the island. It's SOS Pro Wrestling.
Does Mojo really rest in the gorilla suit?
That's amazing.
In the monkey suit? He really does, huh?
He's an actual monkey.
Oh, he's always a monkey.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, he's a monkey.
Clearly,
I'm sorry.
That is not a suit. That is a...
That's a real monkey.
That's a primate.
That's like right out of Planet of the Apes right
that
there.
That learned how to wrestle.
Yeah.
The most popular wrestler. SOS. People love this.
They love Mojo the monkey. Did you ever think that this would be your career? That this would you would hit this high note?
BJ, tonight I hit Mecca.
You hit Mecca, baby.
Edison Square, so.
I just love, okay, you've got it. Do you have this promo pic? You've got to put the promo pick up somewhere on all of our socials.
It's also an SOS Pro Wrestling socials, but yeah, it's online
Nikki,
as well.
Put this up. You've got to share this because Steve looks so serious with that right next to him. It's a freaking monkey guy.
A real monkey.
Steve, I have never seen Steve look so serious. Well, like Steve's like, I will pound a bitch. And Steve's got
I'm
really
going to spank the monkey.
You're going to spank the monkey. But then there's something. I'm sorry.
You broke BJ.
I'm sorry.
This is why
you look so damn serious. Like you're like, this is a legit match.
It is. This is why independent wrestling is very special to me.
I can't do it. You're next to a monkey in a picture. Like you're like, it's on.
It's on.
I mean,
it's on, Mojo.
It's on a monkey.
Monkey's going down, BJ.
I'm sorry. I don't know why that broke me, but that broke me.
Well, I'm going to break him tonight.
Okay.
You know there he is, right there. There's the monkey, BJ.
There he is. He's really monkey man.
No, he's monkey monkey.
I mean, he's monkey boy, monkey whatever.
Not monkey boy. He's monkey monkey.
He's monkey monkey.
Right. I don't know how many times I got to say this to you.
I have never. You know what? He's a strapping monkey.
Show some respect to the monkey.
You know what? Every time I spank the monkey, I always show respect.
I recently I threw him down in the last time.
You fought him before?
No, I haven't fought him. I wanted to send him a message.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, look at this.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. You're really spanking that monkey.
He's going to get spanked hard tonight, BJ.
I'm just
talking. So if you want to spank the monkey or watch me spank him. I'm going to move on. Weather, 72 degrees. Either come hang out with Danny at Numo's or me at Edison Square in Tacoma. Thanks to Olympic Hot Tub for giving us the mix report. And that's what's up.
Yesterday, Steve, the monkey spanker, got this one right.
I Want to Be Sedated in Pet Cemetery are hit songs from what band?
The Ramones.
Yes.
1, 2, 3, 4. Oh, that's a great song.
That's every song.
I know, but I Want to Be Sedated is a great song.
Yes, it is.
It is so good. You want a shot of Petey Steve, you got it. 206-803-ROCK. We're playing Beat Migs. Going to do that at 647 on The Rock.
Today's podcast was brought to you by Travis Gagne, bankruptcy attorney. Here's another question from a listener. If I can't afford to pay my bills, how am I going to afford attorneys and bankruptcy fees?
You know, one of the things people ask me all the time as a bankruptcy lawyer is that how am I going to pay all these fees and costs because I'm here because I can't afford to pay my bills? And of course, we understand that. I mean, being in the bankruptcy field. But, you know, one of the things to remember is that if you decide, once you make the decision to file bankruptcy, you can stop paying on all of the creditors that are going to be included in the bankruptcy. And those are the funds that you can use that you have been paying your creditors to pay your attorney fees and court costs to get your case filed. And once your case is filed, you're not going to have most of those payments anymore.
Thanks, Travis. If you have more questions about bankruptcy, you can reach out to Travis anytime at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com. Thanks for listening.
Dealing with an accident and injury claim can be overwhelming. Let Phillips Law Firm fight for you. We understand the pain and suffering, and we're here to guide you through. Call 1-800-JUSTICE today for a free case review or visit justiceforyou.com and let Phillips Law Firm help you on the road to recovery.
It's after bedtime, the kids are asleep, and the moms are out to play.
We're Dina and Kristen, the duo behind the Instagram account Big Little Feelings. I'm Dina, I'm a child therapist and mom of two who nerds out on all things neurobiology and psychology. And Kristen is a parent coach who wrangles three kids on a daily basis, here to give it to us like it is.
We weren't meant to do this parenting thing alone. Consider After Bedtime your village.
Follow After Bedtime with Big Little Feelings on the Odyssey app or wherever you get your podcasts.
Hey, this is BJ. Thanks for listening to our show's podcast. If you're a fan of all things geeky, you should check out my other podcast, BJ Shea's Geek Nation. We have new episodes every day, and you can check it out at bjgeeknation.com.
Your wages are being garnished. We can stop that now. It's hard enough to pay your bills when things are good, let alone when a big chunk of your take-home pay is gone before you even get your check. I'm bankruptcy attorney Travis Gagne, and I can stop the garnishment and get the creditors off your back immediately, often the same day as our consultation. Both Chapter 7 and 13 provide bankruptcy relief, but choosing the right chapter is crucial. In a free consultation, we can create a plan to get your finances back under your control. The chapter you choose sets the tone for the next chapter of your life. Please contact me today at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com.
99.9 KISW, The Rock of Seattle. It's our Loud Local Band of the Week, Devaria. Lesser Loudon Local Band of the Week, Tavaria. If you want to find out how to get their info, just go to the BJ and Migs page of KISW.com.
Recently put out a new record called September, but this week also released a remixed version of it titled September Laced. So check it out.
And if you want to check out some great local music, tune in on Sunday nights right here on The Rock. It's Loudon Local. Starts at 8 o'clock. 2 hours of great Pacific Northwest music. Bands like Tavaria.
To be Migs. I know, I Woo. Sure am, because we made it. It's Friday. It's
Friday, Friday. Hey, Danny's And it's the official first Blue Friday.
It sure is. Yeah. I was about to say, and we're all rocking some Seahawks.
Except someone.
Vicky. I'm wearing the KISW summer tee. Oh.
And that has to do with the Seahawks how?
I forgot. Yeah.
I've got to see it.
Wait a second.
Look down.
We're all connected underneath my Seahawks jersey.
You did a little bit of both.
Get it at the Rock Shop at KSW.com.
Woo! For what it's worth, I did give Sarah my old Seahawks tee, so in a way, it's a little bit of me on Sarah.
I mean, that's a stretch, but okay.
Yes, yeah, I'm not. That's all I got.
She literally gave it to me yesterday, though, so it was kind of perfect. I was like, oh, great, I have something to wear today. Let's get to our contestant. We have Joe Dredd from Seattle. Joe Dredd, are you there?
Yes, I am. Good morning, everybody.
Hey, what's up, Joe?
All right, Steve, now get out of here. For those playing at home, Joe Dredd has 60 seconds to answer 10 questions. You can pass all you want, but you will only get 3 guesses per question. Are you ready?
Well, first of all, I gotta let you know, it's a tag team. I brought in my ringer, my lovely and smart wife, Healy. Say hi, Healy.
Hi, everybody.
Hi, Healy. Hello.
I have a feeling she's going to be smarter than you, Joe.
Don't forget, these are the two.
Yes, she is in many ways.
These are the two people that met during one of our listener parties and end up getting married.
Aww. Yeah. Oh, I hope you guys win. Okay, are you both ready?
Yeah.
Beginning with H, Elton John's middle name is the same as what mythological creature?
Hercules.
Yes. What fast food chain uses the slogan, "Have it your way"?
Burger King.
Yes. The opening line of the Friends theme song is followed by how many claps?
5.
No.
6?
No.
4.
Yes. 4. In what country would you find the Leaning Tower of Pisa?
Italy.
Yes. Yeah. Same name as a board game. What is the part of the skull that encloses the brain called?
Cranium.
Yes. Edward Cullen is a character from what movie film franchise?
Twilight.
Yes.
Yeah.
The Cavaliers is a basketball team from what city?
Cleveland.
Yes. Halley's Comet was last seen in Earth's skies in what decade?
70s.
No.
80s. 90s.
Yes. 80s. Who is Travis Barker currently married to?
A Kardashian.
Which one?
It's Khloe Courtney.
Courtney, yes. What does the DC stand for in Washington, D.C.?
District of Columbia.
Yes, and with that, you get a perfect 10.
Wow, I question the Kardashian question. I mean, you know, you got to just say no or yes. You can't even get...
Well, really?
I don't know, man. This whole thing is tainted. But
she gave no clues? I'll take the
10 because I want the win.
He's complaining.
Yeah.
Because I have to be fair with my complaints. I would complain if she did that with Steve.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And I have a bone to pick with you with that question about the mythological.
Okay. Yeah. Of course, you know.
Yeah, I don't like it.
Steve, are you ready?
Yes! Yes! Yes!
He's going down.
Let's go. Yeah, Joe is very arrogant about this, but he's also very confident because he had Healy help him.
Well, good for him.
Right? Beginning with H, Elton John's middle name is the same as what mythological creature?
What?
Beginning with H, Elton John's middle name. No.
Hercules.
Yes. Nice. What fast food chain uses the slogan, have it your way?
Burger King.
Yes. The opening line of the Friends theme song is followed by how many claps?
Four.
Yes.
Unbelievable.
In what country would you find the Leaning Tower of Pisa?
What country? Italy.
Yes. Same name as a board game. What is the part of the skull that encloses the brain called?
Cranium.
Yes.
I love that game.
Edward Cullen is a character from what movie film franchise?
Twilight?
Yes.
Nice.
The Cavaliers is a basketball team from what city? Yes. Halley's Comet was last seen in Earth's skies in what decade?
90s.
No.
Oh. 80s.
Yes. Who is Travis Barker currently married to?
One of the Kardashians. Kim Kardashian?
No.
Khloe Kardashian?
No.
That was the other one. Crap. Kourtney Kardashian.
Yes. What does the DC stand for in Washington, D.C.?
District of Columbia.
Yes. And with that, you get a perfect 10, which is a tie.
Yeah, no song for you, buddy.
10 to 10.
No. Like, I'm playing DJ buddy. Khaled?
Nope.
No. Not playing anything.
No.
Wow.
Nice work, you two.
Good job.
That was a good game.
That was amazing. I don't remember the last time we've had a perfect 10 tie.
Man.
Right?
Yeah.
That was quite a thing.
That was like an hour-long drawn wrestling right there.
Well, Team Joe and Healy, you can play anytime.
Thank you, guys. We'll talk to you later.
All right, there
Have a great weekend.
All right, there we go.
I'm so impressed by everyone's smarts right now.
Yeah.
I thought I was going to get screwed on the Kardashian one, which I wouldn't be the first person to be screwed by a Kardashian.
The truth.
Waka waka.
Well, and that's the one that he said Kardashian, and I said which one.
And I thought that was like you just said no.
Oh.
We got to be specific, but man, I couldn't say no to Kardashian because it is a Kardashian.
Yeah, that's a tough one for me.
Whatever.
Yeah, I just.
I'm okay with that.
This whole game is.
So what's the other one that you had? You had a bone to pick.
No, I can't. You know what? You got it right. You were my canary in a coal mine for that one. But since you got it right, I'm not gonna complain about it.
Yeah, I was a little confused too. I'm like, wait, what? I'm like, unicorn. No,
yeah, a mythological creature. I don't call a god a creature. I would say a being.
Oh yeah, people are texting in saying Hercules was a demigod, not a creature.
Yes, Sarah.
I swear on Google, it says he's a mythological creature.
Character. Mythological character.
Oh, damn, you lose.
I was just naming anything that sounded fancy with the letter H.
You guys got lucky because I missed the H. I missed the H when you first asked the question. So I'm thinking like Minotaur, whatever.
Oh,
you
know. I would have not gotten that right if you didn't say the letter H.
Yeah. Well,
that's
so.
Why I
so
did it. Elton
Hercules John?
Yes, isn't that epic?
I had no idea that was his middle name.
That is awesome.
Right?
That's fantastic. All right, good for you, Elton.
Hercules.
And the fact is, I never really heard him, like, really just say that name much either.
I Elton's not bad either, but I think I might be going by, like, I'm Hercules John. Oh, he does, like, a rock career. Like, he has, like, a side project that's, like, a rock band, and it's Hercules John.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
That's way more epic than Elton.
Yeah. I mean, especially in those days when you're getting ready with a stage name, I wonder if anybody ever said, maybe you should be Hercules John. You know, and he was like, no, I think I'll just be Elton. Are you having any problems at work? Maybe you've got some relationship issues or any other random problem where you think, hey, man, our advice will be helpful. But you know us. We're here for you. Call us, text us, 206-803-ROCK. It's help wanted. We're going to do that at 717 on The Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW. Is your relationship going sideways?
Have a family issue? Problems with your coworker?
Do you need advice? We're here to help. No problem is too dumb. No dilemma is too silly. This is Help Wanted with BJ and Migs.
99.9 KISW, The Rock of Seattle. You know, for years on this fine program, because we have just been through so much in life, lots of rockaholics have been giving us texts and messages, phone calls saying, hey, can you help me out with something, man? Whatever problem it might be. And it could be relationships. It could be something at work. Anything you got going on. Now, I know what you're thinking. Yeah, but what I got going on is pretty dumb. Yeah, but that's us. That's our expertise. We are pretty good at dumb problems. So whatever you need, we are here for you. 206-803-ROCK. It is Help Wanted.
All right. What do we want to do? Do we want to get to this one that involves a truck? Or do we want to do one that involves kicking a person out of the house?
Well, we've done kicking out of the house before. I feel like the truck thing, it intrigues me, the truck thing.
Okay, good, because I've been kind of wanting to get to this one. So let's go with it. Help Wanted. This one involves my truck that is slowly becoming the family truck.
Oh.
Many years ago, I bought a truck so I could do stuff around the house, dump runs, Home Depot, picking up some random stuff. But over the last couple of years, a family member has also asked to use the truck over the last few years. And I have no problem with this because they usually take care of it and they're respectful. Although recently they've been offering it also to their friends, and they decided to sell their SUV because they could just borrow the truck. So it's starting to feel a lot less like my truck and more like community property.
Yeah, I don't understand how somebody has the gall to offer up an item that is not theirs.
That is insane. And then they said, seriously, it's become kind of annoying. Like, I appreciate that they're washing it, they're putting gas in it, but still, they're putting wear and tear on it. And sometimes I don't get it back for days at a time. How do I talk to this family member like I don't, to get them to stop using it?
I would love, I know they're trying to be covert and ambiguous, but gosh, it feels like an in-law to me.
Ooh.
It just feels like an in-law to me. Because if it was my sibling, I think I could go, hey, what are you doing? What are you doing here?
That's a good question.
Why?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, why are you offering my truck out to other people? That's not cool. I feel like it's an in-law.
And it's so crazy that they're like, yeah, let's get rid of our SUV. We don't need that big vehicle anymore. But they probably got like a sedan or something, I'm imagining, because we could just use John's truck.
Yeah. If I were to borrow somebody's vehicle, I would be having them drive it. Like, I wouldn't even want to drive it.
I would be okay with borrowing someone, like a family member, like if they had like a pickup and I needed to do some stuff. But that would be maybe once in a blue moon.
Yeah.
I'm not even saying once a year. It might be like once every few years that I might be like, hey, can I borrow your truck again? I would feel so like out of line if I was constantly asking somebody to use their truck to the point where I got rid of my SUV. And then also, oh, my neighbors, you want to use a truck? I'll just borrow John's and you can use it.
I feel like at this point, he should just start charging. If it isn't paid off yet, start charging them. Like, okay,
wow.
You're going to help pay for my monthly payment,
wow,
as well as insurance.
You're going to do that. So if your brother or your mother or your father, you're really going to do that?
Like, if this is going to be the family vehicle,
wow,
then as a family, we need to pay for it.
I want to be there for that conversation. That's bold. I don't necessarily disagree with you, but that's a bold conversation with siblings and parents.
I hate borrowing stuff or having like anything like that. So if I was in a position where I needed to borrow it a lot, I would offer to pay for a portion.
I don't know why we're making it so difficult. I'm with this texture. So learn how to say no. Yeah. Just say, look, man, no more. I'm sorry. Like, I know I have this, but you've worn out your welcome with my truck.
You know, you boundary people, it's so easy for you, okay? You know, they didn't write a book called Boundaries because everybody has good boundaries.
I understand. It isn't easy. I understand that's hard to just beg. Look, I had to do that recently when I got my new car, and somebody in our family was like, can they use your car? And I literally just got it like a couple days before that because they needed a bigger vehicle. Not that I have a big car, it's Sportage, but it's,
oh, your car's so big.
Right, and I'm just like, I've barely driven this car, and I trust them. But I was just like, no, I just got this car.
How do you do that? Is it the word N and the word O? You can put it together like
that?
Yeah,
but you know what? I even prepped. I'm like, I feel terrible saying this because I know that they're not going to do any damage to it, but I haven't even put 10 miles on this car, and I'm already being asked to loan it out.
Yeah.
No, because God forbid they do mess it up. And yeah, it's under insurance. And yeah, I just got the car and all that. You know, it's warranted. But I was just like, I don't want to deal with the headache if something weird happens.
Yeah.
Give me at least a couple months before you need to use my car.
I think that's just courtesy. You don't ask to borrow somebody's new vehicle right away. You got to, what do you mean? I think 3 months. You got to have the car for 3 months before somebody starts borrowing it.
Man, I feel like you got to have it for a year or,
ooh,
the first dent.
Okay.
Yes.
Whichever comes first.
Oh, yeah,
okay.
The first dent. Yeah, then you know they don't care anymore.
Yeah, once I get that first dent, it's like scuffing a pair of sneakers. Once that happens, then all bets are off.
Yeah, my brother.
Then I'm parking all willy-nilly. I don't care.
See, I'm in that same boat. My brother just bought himself a really nice new car, and he's like, hey, do you want to just move it for me? I won't even move it to another parking spot until that first dent is there.
Yeah.
Or a year. It needs to be a good while. I don't want to drive it.
I don't like driving Sarah's car for that reason, because so far it doesn't. And I'm so upset at Sarah, because you know how she hits everything very quickly. She still hasn't put a dent in that car. And
she,
it's like, oh,
I was going to say, you don't like driving her car. She doesn't like driving her car
true.
Either. So.
Who's driving her car then?
Nobody. One. Literally, times BJ's not even around, she's driving BJ's car.
She's barely in her 30s and she's already become grandma and grandpa that put no miles on their vehicle.
Oh, yeah.
That's amazing.
Oh, yeah. She always takes my car. My car's a 2004. I'm like, look, dude, I don't need to be putting more miles on this thing. I'm trying to like have it last longer.
I like the textures. A couple of them are bringing up the
textures?
Yes, it's rare, but I do like the textures.
Okay, what are they saying here?
One person said, I was taught if I needed to borrow something more than three times, it's time for me to buy my own. Another text, if you borrow it three times, you should own it.
Oh, the three strikes, you're out rule. I like it.
That's a great idea. Yeah, if you need to borrow it three times, I'm sorry.
Well, these people went the other way. They borrowed it more than three times, and they sold their bigger vehicle and downsized.
I couldn't imagine doing that. Like that, yeah. I don't have that mindset. Like, hey, we should get rid of our SUV. Why? Well, we could use John's car, his truck all the time. I'm like, no, that's a little, we're imposing at that.
I wonder if the truck person can tell us if it's a sibling or just say non-sibling. Like, not immediate family member. I know they're trying to be vague. But I really think, don't you think if it was your sibling or your parent, you could say something? Because I feel like you would be able to go, hey.
In-laws definitely, or maybe not even in-laws, it could be like, I'm thinking father and mother-in-law, but like a brother-in-law. Yeah, you might be like, oh.
This is a tough one.
Am I making it awkward for my significant other?
Maybe a cousin also might be tough. But
I'd say no to cousins all the time. I don't even know all my cousins' names.
Oh, look at you. That's the way to do it. That's the way to do it. I don't know my brother's middle name, but you got that with your cousins. I love it.
So they said you bought the truck for projects around the house and dump runs, and now you're worried about wear and tear? It's a work vehicle. Okay. But it's his work vehicle.
Yeah. Oh, boy. Listen to this person. This is a person.
That's the in-law.
That's the in-law.
Like, yeah. He bought it for dump runs and stuff around the house for his stuff.
You don't have a right to tell anybody what to do with their stuff or even judge how they use their stuff. Remember the guy that kept borrowing my freezer pack?
Yeah.
I hate that guy. To this day, I hate that guy.
Well, good for you. Doesn't work here anymore.
I know, but every once in a while, I see him on Facebook, and I just want to go, you know what? You come off so nice, and you're telling everybody with your spiritual, inspirational messages, and you stole my freezer pack when I needed it with a sore back.
Stole is a very strong term. He borrowed it daily.
He put it on his skin. At that point, you're stealing. I don't want your sweaty ass all over my squeezer pack, or freezer pack, that too.
Or your squeezer pack. But he always put it back at the end of the day.
Dude, I wrote on it. It had a name. This is BJ's freezer, but it didn't matter. He took it anyway. Yeah. I was sore. I go to the store. It rhymes with sore. Buy your own.
It rhymes. Why buy one when there's one at work that he could just use?
See, you're that texter.
I'm kidding.
You're that texter, aren't you?
I'm being a douche.
I know, and that's the problem. How is it that people, I don't know how people are wired to think like, what's yours is yours, and what's mine is mine, and what's yours is mine too now. It's just like, what is that about? Where you just feel like everybody's stuff is yours.
Someone says, yeah, you got to set clear boundaries with the truck. They need to, if they want to use it, sure. But they need to let you know. And obviously some person saying they got to pay you money for it. Give you 19 bucks or 20 bucks a day.
Look, dudes don't want to hear this.
U-Haul has gone generations with that business model.
Yeah,
Sign it up for Turo. Isn't that the one where you can like rent it out to people?
Oh, it's the Airbnb for trucks?
Yeah, and then just, or cars, and then just send them a link to that. Be like, you want to rent it? You got to book through here.
That's a great idea. The thing is this, is that, it's for me anyway, therapeutically speaking, and look, dudes probably don't want to go this deep, but here's the thing. There's something therapeutically in me that makes it very difficult for me to say no reasonably. Like, I feel like I always have to say yes. This is why we now have a new dog in our household that will be coming to my household very soon, and I'm not happy about this, but I said yes. Mm. I thought, well, the dog will be in California. What's the problem? But now the wife's like, I want to come back. Want to hang with the family. I go, what are you, selling the dog? What are you doing? What's happening? Is that? And it's all because I couldn't say no. So now I got another freaking little dog, and they live forever, those little dogs. the big dog, has got 7, 8, 10 years, you're good.
Is it going to sleep in your bed?
But a little dog is like 15. No, I'm not pulling a Steve where it's going to be like diarrhea Fido. It's not going to be in my bed.
Oh, she's better now. She just had some stomach issues. She's been fine. After that third poop in the bed, she hasn't done it
after
again.
After the third? No,
after the second, actually.
Oh, yeah. I was going to say, I thought three strikes, she was out. Right.
Yeah. No, she never got to the third strike. She's been great, but she has been hogging my spot.
Okay, dude. Spoiler alert. This is not going to be the last.
She takes up more of the bed than my wife and I. And we have a Cal King.
I didn't realize your bed was that big.
Stretches out.
I'm not.
Snores.
It's like a little dog, too.
It's like 10 pounds.
What does a dog go? The opposite direction? Like you guys are sleeping vertically and she's sleeping horizontally.
Pretty much. If you're looking from up above, we've created the letter H.
I gotta say,
with a really long line between the two tall lines.
I always worry about new parents, whether or not they let the kids stay in the bed with them, and they say, should you do that?
Hell no. Nope. Tatum's not allowed.
Hell no, yes, but the dog is.
Well, she's kind of grandfathered in now.
Yeah, that's it.
How do you tell this poor blind dog that you can't lie in the bed anymore?
Well, you tell him by not putting him in the bed and putting him in a crate, and they don't speak English anyway, and they're dogs.
Oh, she speaks English.
Oh, yeah, she does. She says, all right.
It's not her first language, but she definitely speaks.
I can't even have this conversation.
So who do you go to? You go to a truck therapist? Is it like Leo the truck? Or what's going on here? Like
Leo the truck. Well, you just have to know how to say no. I mean, it's and Steve, people like you that know how to do that. I'm always envious of people like you because I don't want to be that jerk. I don't want people to hate me when I say no to them, which is why I never say no. I have a hard time.
I was always that type. I never wanted to say no either. And then one day, I remember the first time I did it and how it felt after I said no. I was like, why don't I do this more? It was like someone wanted me to go to a party. And I'm like, they're like, are you going to come to a party? I used to be that guy. It's like, oh, yeah, I'll try and make it. And then I would find a reason not to. But I couldn't ever just tell them point blank. And then one time I'm like, no, I'm not going to be able to make it. And they're like, well, why aren't you going to make it? I'm like, I just kind of want to stay home and just do my thing. And they were like, oh, okay, not a big deal. And I was like, oh, saying no isn't really as hard as I thought it was.
I know, man. I got deep-rooted stuff. I have to do a lot of work to say no.
Like, you don't have to go, no! You don't have to yell at
That's what happens to me, because I say there's so many yeses that pile up, and then all of a sudden,
I snap.
And I use the anger, the unresolved anger, as fuel to advocate for myself. It is a horrific pattern that I've been in my whole life. Whereas the only way I can actually stand up for myself is if I'm so angry that I've been taken advantage of by everybody that I feel like now I'm warranted. But the problem is a guy like you will go, hey, BJ, would you like to go over here? And I'm like, no, you effer. And you're just like, what is happening? Why am I getting DEFCON 5? And it is because I let myself get walked all over for all those other times. You don't know that because you're just like a regular dude asking a question that you'll take either yes or no. I don't know that.
I have some more information. So I said that the truck is fully paid off, but my dad has told them that they should be helping pay for repairs. They keep saying that they will help, but they haven't helped with crap, and parts are starting to break. And also, apparently, it's the sibling's spouse.
Ah, that's an in-law.
Yes.
I suspected it was an in-law.
Yeah.
Yeah, see, and...
Yeah, you tell Fred to go F off.
Yeah, see?
Get your own truck, Fred.
God, we nailed it. I love it when we just nail things. We just know what the story is.
It's just time and time again we show how smart we are.
Yeah. We just know. We've dealt with douches for a long time. Well, Steve has, anyway.
And, daily.
Yeah, exactly. Danny's right there.
I'll close my eyes next time I say that.
Yeah, wow. There we go. So, your dad's on the right track, and really, your sibling needs to step up. Yeah, I mean, you got to go to your sibling and go, this is enough. No sibling likes to be put in the middle of anything, but the bottom line is this, is that you got to know sometimes, as a sibling, it's tough for your in-laws to basically, you know, interact with your other sibling. You got to figure that out. And especially that's just wrong.
Yeah.
But some people feel that way. Oh, it's good to have a plumber in the family. It's good to have a doctor in the, you know, and then I've seen that in my own family. And it's like, that is not cool. This person is like you're glomming all over this. Why?
No, it's good to have them, but pay them their rate.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, contribute to their what they do for a living.
Then. I agree, man. I mean, that's instead of just taking the truck and doing nothing. Like, where's the gift cards? Where's the Starbucks? Where's the Amazon? Where's something? Yeah.
Time to say no.
You ought to do a class. You ought to just do videos.
It'll be the easiest video.
Yeah.
I wouldn't get monetized because it would be too short. Be like, when someone asks you something you don't want to do, say no.
You know, the best
video. Tune in next week when I tell you more about this.
Here's the perfect video. It'll be one. I'll go, Steve, would you do a video about how teaching people to say no?
No.
Okay, that's the video.
No.
That's the series.
No disrespect, but yeah. No, I don't have time.
What is the most epic thing that has happened to you at a party? Now, granted, Steve doesn't go to those. For one guy... How about this? For one guy at a party, he was attacked by a bear. And he survived. That is pretty epic at a party. You're going to hear what happened at 7:47 on The Rock.
Today's podcast was brought to you by Travis Gagne, bankruptcy attorney. He's here right now and has agreed to answer more of your questions about bankruptcy. How much does bankruptcy cost?
Usually with my office, we do a flat fee that includes all your court costs, filing fees, credit counseling, credit reports, and one cost. In Chapter 13 cases, that usually starts at about $900 with Chapter 7 cases. So total costs, including all your court costs, attorney fees, is usually about $1,500. We offer payment plans on Chapter 7, so you can start a file with my office for as little as $200. You can send your creditor calls to us. We'll take your creditor calls while you get
gather up your information and make payments on the rest of the fees. With Chapter 13 cases, we can make payment arrangements in most cases as well and get your case filed even sooner in a Chapter 13 case because of the reorganization aspect to it.
Thanks, Travis. If you have more questions about bankruptcy, you can reach out to Travis anytime at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com. Thanks for listening.
Are you dealing with a personal injury? Don't go it alone. Turn to the experienced team at Phillips Law Firm. Their attorneys have helped thousands of clients get the compensation they deserve. Call Phillips Law Firm now. Call 1-800-JUSTICE or visit justiceforyou.com.
It's after bedtime, the kids are asleep, and the moms are out to play.
We're Dina and Kristen, the duo behind the Instagram account Big Little Feelings. I'm Dina. I'm a child therapist and mom of two who nerds out on all things neurobiology and psychology. And Kristen is a parent coach who wrangles three kids on a daily basis, here to give it to us like it is.
We weren't meant to do this parenting thing alone. Consider After Bedtime your village.
Follow After Bedtime with Big Little Feelings on the Odyssey app or wherever you get your podcasts.
Hey, this is BJ. Thanks for listening to our show's podcast. If you're a fan of all things geeky, you should check out my other podcast, BJ Shea's Geek Nation. We have new episodes every day, and you can check it out at bjgeeknation.com.
Your driver's license is important so you can get back and forth to work, get your kids to school, and back and forth to daycare. If your license has been suspended because you can't pay your tickets, you can't do any of those things. Let's talk about Chapter 13 bankruptcy. You may have heard that tickets cannot be discharged, but they can be dealt with in a Chapter 13 case. Why not come in for a free consultation? The chapter you choose will make all the difference to your getting back, legally, on the road. Let's design a plan to pay off your tickets and restore your license immediately. I'm attorney Travis Gagne. Please contact me today at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com.
99.9 KISW, the Rock of Seattle. This is a wild story about a bear that walked into an outdoor party in the Poconos Mountains of Pennsylvania.
I am watching this video right now, BJ, and this is the craziest video I've ever seen where this bear is just kind of hanging out in like almost like a campsite. Like they have, but they have a TV set up.
Yeah.
They've got a barbecue, like a full on barbecue, like, you know, not like one that would be on your back deck, not like a portable one. They've got it all decked out, including like a little fenced off area as well. And then there's a bear just hanging out with all of them.
Yeah, and I mean, this bear, okay, maybe it's a cub. I mean, it's not a gigantically...
Big bear!
It's hard to say. I mean, he's not standing up.
Yeah, but I'd say he's a solid, like, what, 300-pound bear?
Oh, he's a good-sized bear.
Yeah.
But, I mean, this is nuts that he's just hanging out. I still think he would hurt you, like you say, because he's a solid 300 pounds. I'm just wondering why everyone is so cool with this bear. Like, I would be like... I'm out of here. Let the bear do what it wants.
You don't want to freak out with a bear, probably. You don't want to, like, startle it. But the crazy part is everybody's backing up except for this one guy who almost seems like the dude that's, like, you know, the owner of a home when you have, like, someone at the party that's gotten a little too drunk. And you're like, Danny, come with me, man. We got to walk outside. Yeah, like, I got to get you an Uber and you have to leave. And,
yeah.
Like, you know, and, like, stays by your side and kind of, like, escorts you out of the establishment. And this guy is doing that with this bear. Like, he's right next to the bear, almost talking to the bear, like, you had too many picnic baskets. You got to go, man.
Yeah. It's this guy, Mike, I think you're talking about. And everyone else at the party is like, Mike, don't do this. But Mike's like, I don't care. I'm going to walk this bear out. And he gets mauled once on the side of his rib cage before the bear does walk out of the gate.
Come on. Did I get
it? Come on.
Hey.
Mike, hey, no, Mike.
Just move.
Mike.
Just move.
Oh, my God.
I have that on video.
Look, Mike got him from a bear.
I mean, barely got him.
Yeah.
But he did, like, dude, he's got, like, smarks. He's got,
yeah,
like,
he does.
It's like he got scratched up the paw. Yeah, the bear's just like, F you, man, I'm out.
Yeah.
And then, dude, Mike just closes the gate on this, like, little area that they're in, like, almost like, all right, bear's out of here. We're good to go now.
Man, he's scratching right through that shirt.
Yes.
Man, dude, that's a beating. That's a...
It almost surprised me that Mike is still alive. Like, Mike just seems like the type of guy that makes really bad decisions.
And it looked like a camping area, but as I saw them escorting him out the gate, there's a house over there.
Yes.
So it's like, this looks like it's kind of a neighborhood camping or hangout spot. I don't know. It's like... I didn't expect there to be a house.
It's up against the water, though.
Yeah, I'm guessing it's like one of those, like, maybe that they own that little private area or it's a communal private
area. Like a little common area.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, see, I love nature. I love being out with the trees and stuff like that. But this is the problem, is you got Billy the Bear hanging out.
All fairness, Mike invited the bear. Yeah. I mean, he came with him. And
he's
then,
like, hey, boo-boo, come on over.
Mike had, some, you know, the bear had too much honey. It just got kind of weird.
Oh, bother.
It's such a weird thing. But do you... Mike's partying hard for the rest of the night. I feel like everybody's buying Mike a drink.
Yeah, and I think this is Mike a little... He has to be a little inebriated, right, to even try this.
Oh, I don't think that's a question. I think he's wasted,
Yeah, definitely. That's what I thought.
I think everybody else has a drink in their hand, and he almost has, like, the little drunk walk.
He does,
Mike is almost doing, like, that drunk walk. Like,
let's come on, go, bear.
You gotta go.
Yeah.
Remember last time you showed up?
Damn, dude. I mean, that, it's funny what alcohol will do, because I would be so nervous. I'd be gone. I'd be like, I don't care what you're saying. I'm not supposed to be afraid. I'm out. Yeah.
But this is the story that will last forever.
Yeah.
That's the one thing. Like, Mike will forever be known as the guy who escorted the bear out of the party and got swiped at.
Yeah. Yeah. Mike is legendary. You know, he's like Frank the Tank at this point.
And they got video to prove it.
Yeah. Look at Mike. Mike is, don't mess with Mike when he's drunk. He's already, at this point, you're like, okay, just, but Mike seemed real calm about it.
Yeah.
He wasn't, you know, he wasn't like, you know, get out of here, bear, you know, like that dude that just says F off, bear. He was actually quite calm.
So he says, one time we had a party and my buddy did too many mushrooms and decided to get completely naked and just run around the neighborhood. That was the most epic moment. The cops were called.
That is a Frank the Tank moment right there.
That is pretty amazing.
Wow, that's... How do you come back from that?
It makes me think of, you know the singer Ben Folds, obviously.
Oh, yeah.
I love Ben Folds. And he had that record, Rock in the Suburbs. And there's a song on that record called Not the Same. And it's one of my all-time favorite songs because of the story that he shares. And it's about a person that he knew that got, like, high on LSD at a party and ended up, like, on top of the house, stayed in a tree overnight.
Whoa.
And then eventually came down the next morning and became a born-again Christian. And I'm like, that is an amazing story.
Really? He just like, okay, I'm done with drugs and alcohol or whatever, and I'm just going to go turn to the Lord.
And I think anyone who's had a crazy acid trip probably hears that song and hears that story. It's like, yeah, I can understand that.
A lot of people do make deals with God when they're tripping.
Oh, yes.
A lot of people go, dude, if you can get me out of here.
I remember being like on acid in a river, and I was like right by the water part, and I'm in the dirty spot, and my hands are just digging into the ground.
Whoa.
Because I'm convinced if I let go, I'm leaving the planet. Okay. Like that's how
you thought you were gonna float away.
Dude, that's how much I was tripping.
That's
so I'm holding on for dear life, and I'm staring at the sun. Really smart.
Yeah.
And then I just start crying uncontrollably because I'm staring at the sun, but in my head I'm convinced that God is talking to me. And he's like, let go, man. Just let go.
Go to the light, Stephen. Go to the light.
I wonder if I let go. Next day, I'd be born again. Like, there you go.
Yeah.
See you guys. I'm out.
What if you did float away?
That would have really tripped out my friends.
Yeah, that for sure
would. They'd be like, guys.
Dude, I mean, it's weird.
Steve just floated away, man.
I saw stuff, and I saw stuff on ayahuasca that was just like, wait a minute. But then when people confirm that stuff was happening to them, and I saw them being attacked by these creature beings that didn't exist, but they were having, I'm like, did that really happen? Did I really see these shadow beings beat up my friend? Because he was having a hard time.
And,
he said, I felt like I was being attacked by these beings. I'm like, I felt like I saw beings attack you. Were we both sharing our own cycle? I mean, we're tripping. We were just tripping balls.
This was also the same trip that then I gathered a bunch of rocks. And because like everything was like pulsating, I'm holding the rock. And I'm convinced that this rock is beating. Like, I'm like, there's a heart inside of this. And so then I'm like stacking them and I'm like looking at all these rocks that are beating. And I'm like, they're living. These rocks are alive, man. And then people are walking by that have nothing to do with our little group. Like, you know, we're all trying to play it cool. But then there's dumbass Steve digging his hands in the dirt, holding on for dear life, playing with rocks. And they're walking by it, and I'm like yelling at people. I'm like, walk around the rocks, man. And they're like, what? I'm like, the rocks are alive.
Okay,
walk around.
All right, Mushroom Boy, we'll keep that in mind.
That's Acid Boy, man.
Oh, Acid Boy, then. Acid Boy. Oh, Acid Boy's even better than Mushroom Boy.
Yep. Yeah, and that's the story that the Ted Smith showed at the Roast of Steve Migs, where I have a rock on my chest. I got that entire experience tattooed on my chest.
Oh, right.
Because it was just so ridiculous. And it was like one of those memories I'll never forget. It's dumb. I get it.
The rocks are alive, man.
The rocks are alive, man. And it's just like a giant heart that has a bunch of rocks breaking from it. And it's because of that stupid trip that I went on.
It's interesting, man, because, you know, do hallucinogenics make you trippy and hallucinate, or do they allow you to see on another level?
Dun, dun, yeah, man.
You know, where you could actually see the rocks breathing.
I have never kicked a rock ever since then.
I don't blame you.
Respect the rocks, bro.
I know that science...
Respect the rocks.
You got to respect the rocks, man. I just read that scientists have a way to be able to hear plants scream, which I was like, wait, plants scream? And they go, yeah, like they have a way. They like, if you pull things off, they make noises. We just can't hear them.
Then how do they know?
Well, they have devices that, like, you know, basically give them super listening or something. And this article is just
like
crazy.
A Whisper 2000. You remember those things that we got, like the infomercials?
Yeah, you can hear anything with those.
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's apparently too high a frequency for humans to hear.
Can dogs hear it?
I don't know.
They haven't asked the dogs yet. The dogs refuse to be part of the survey.
Sometimes they think about it. We were at the Washington State Fair. And
you were?
They had like a little bee exhibit thing. And they have this little fun farm thing set up for kids where you go around, you collect like these little fake eggs. Then you collect like fake apples.
For kids, he says.
Oh, yeah. And in the end, they collect it all in their little lunchbox. But now they have like a little setup for a little bee setup where you can kind of see how like bees pollinate and learn about all that crap. And then they also have, you hit a button, you can, it'll show you like what a flower looks like to a human. And then you hit the other button, it's like what the flower looks like to a bee.
Oh, they got all those crazy eyes.
Yeah, but I'm like, how do we know that's really how they see?
Well, that's a really
good... None of us are bees.
Yeah. Well, I think that they, I mean, scientifically, they've just been able to sort of figure that out by, I mean, they've been able to like dissect and use like big microscopes. Maybe they take the eye out and look through it.
But still, you're still not. You don't have a bee brain. You don't know how it's processing it, man. I feel like scientists are just effing with us with that kind of stuff.
That's an interesting
thing. This
is
how a dog sees. I'm like, how do we know for sure?
Oh, so you don't believe it?
Well, I think that there's a lot of questions that need to be answered.
All right. Well, you know what? I'm not going to say you're wrong because I'm not an expert in how that stuff goes. But I think it is fascinating that if it's true that like, with all those compound eyes and ways dogs
see. It's cool.
See,
yeah.
You know, because dogs, do they say they don't see all colors? They don't see it. People used to think dogs saw in black and white, but right. Now they're figuring out that that's not the case.
And do we really know that for sure?
Well, all I know is that if we can colorize black and white shows, can't we colorize a dog's vision? Or
but you never like, hey, Spot, is this blue? Rough.
I thought you said you spoke English. Like Lulu spoke. I thought she spoke English.
Dude, Lulu's blind. Don't be stupid.
Oh, I'm sorry.
She can't see at all.
Oh, I forgot about that. That's very insensitive to ask her what color something is.
She can't see anything right now.
Yeah, that's a good point.
She just feels walls when she walks into them.
Yeah. Oh boy, I know, dude. I remember those days. That's not a fun time.
Dude, to go back to that whole bear story with Mike.
Yes.
Versus like Mike's gonna wake up the next day and go, "What the hell was I thinking?"
Yes.
That is definitely one of those moments.
Because they got the video. Now, I don't know if Mike's blacked out. That's the other thing is sometimes people black out and don't remember. And if you wake up and you see, first of all, you've got these giant claw marks. And you're like, what the F? And then they go, oh, yeah, Mike, let's watch a little video. Do you basically need a new pair of pants going, why did you people let me do this? I could have died.
Yeah, but you're like, dude, Mike, you were adamant about handling this. He did escort the bear out.
I do like how it actually, if you watch the video, it kind of looks like the bear was just trying to give him a high five. Like, thanks, dude. See you later.
I'm out, bro.
I'm heading out to the nut of the party.
Can I get my keys?
Yeah.
Give me my car keys, man. I'm sober.
If you want to see this video, basically we're talking about this guy, Mike, who was at a party, and a bear just wandered into their party area, and Mike decided in his drunken stupor to escort the bear out, and the bear basically scratched the hell out of him a little bit. It's on the BJ and Migs page of KISW.com, and that's why we're just tripping. Like, Mike was trashed, and do you think he knows that he did that?
When you watch him without audio, though, it does kind of look like he's having a conversation with the bear. Yeah. Like, dude, you hit on Janet. You know she's married. You got to go. You had that kind of vibe where he's like, dude, you made an ass of yourself. You got to go, bear.
My favorite part is the cigar in his hand as well as he's walking him out, too. Just like, it's so chill.
Yeah. That is an adult bear, and Mike is a legend.
That is an adult bear.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know, I keep thinking of, like, the giant grizzly bears. You know what I mean? I guess there are, like, granted, that's still a heavy bear and can still do damage to you, but it just, to me, it was like, wow, I don't want to mistake that little guy for a friendly guy because he doesn't look as big as I expect bears to look. Because he didn't, I wouldn't do it. I don't care. Damn, Mike. All right, well.
It's amazing that Mike is still with us.
I agree. Yeah. I mean, and what do you do? I mean, if that bear went nuts, I mean, that's why I'm like, why are you people just hanging around?
Well, what are they going to do?
I'm running. That's what I'm telling you. I am getting the F out of there. I'm not recording this. I am out.
After a few drinks, I'm like, I kind of want to see how this is going to play out.
See, that's why you're going to be dead and I'm going to be alive.
After a few drinks. Okay.
Yeah.
You would be sober, Steve, doing it.
After a lemonade, I'd still be like, dude, Mike's, I don't know what's about to happen, but I kind of want to see what's going to happen.
Yeah. And I'm like, Steve, I will watch the video and be alive.
Yeah, well, if he's going after Mike, he's going to be busy with Mike. I'll still have time. Once he starts mauling Mike, thankfully.
Oh, then you're gonna, then you're out. Then you're like, okay, time to go, honey.
Then I'm going to back up and get the hell out of there.
I am getting in my car, and I might watch from that distance. You know? Oh, man. Oh. Anyway, you can check out that video of Mike and the Bear at KISW.com. Just go to the BJ and Migs page. How about one of the most popular celebrities around just surprised a bus full of tourists? But I am being told by the staff that this will piss me off.
Yes.
I wonder who it is. I wonder why. We'll talk about this at 8:17 on The Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW.
99.9 KISW, The Rock of Seattle. I can't believe you're even bringing this guy up. He's in a big controversy, Steve.
Who's this?
Who's this? Dwayne The Rock Johnson.
The man, the myth, the legend.
Here's a shocker. Dwayne The Rock Johnson just shared a video of himself pulling alongside an open-air bus full of tourists in L.A. Of course, he just
what a jerk that he wants to surprise people who are fans of celebrities.
So here's he pulls up against this bus, and he's got, you can check out the video on the BJ and Migs page of KISW.com.
Hey! How you guys doing? You guys doing good? Hey, did you guys go to my house yet? Okay, good. Keep it that way. Bye, guys. Have fun.
Come on. That's cool.
Yeah.
That's and
he,
nice.
Of course, he posts it, though. Like,
well, what else is he supposed to do? We wouldn't know about it unless
that's
he
the point.
It.
He could have been a nice guy to somebody without telling us. Why does he got to post that?
Because then it leads to a fun post of him talking about, like, one of the cool things about being a celebrity is you get to surprise people.
Oh, yeah, like this clip he's talking about? Okay.
That was fun. That kind of stuff is some of the best parts of fame right there. That, like, making their day and free... Getting free, that's always some of the best parts of fame, too.
Okay, this is not the time for him to be posting this stuff because the internet's hating him right now.
Oh, because of the whole Maui stuff that's going on where they donated a bunch of money and people are like, that's not enough money.
Yeah, there's that. The reason I want to bring that up is because of the fact that one of them is so stupid how these news stories just talk about how the internet hates somebody and they get, and they literally just get any idiot on the internet to back up their, and so I was watching one story about how, they're mad at Oprah and they're mad at The Rock because they're asking people to donate money. And the two of them, I think, together donated about $10 million total.
Right. That's not enough with all the money you have.
Which I've said before, it is really a fraction of their fortune. Well, it's a fraction of Oprah's fortune. I don't know how much money The Rock has.
I'm guessing a boatload.
Yeah. But I think that people have said she's a billionaire. But here's the funny thing. They go, and so many people on the internet are upset, like this guy. And then they basically show Opie. Opie's on a video, it's just Opie doing his morning thing, the former radio dude. He's just on a little Facebook video going, here comes Oprah from her tower. And so it's one person that said something who's a rando. It's not like Opie's a professional news person. It's not like Opie has any information about finances. And so they decide to make a whole story about how the internet hates those two when it was just Opie. And I laughed my ass off going, one person shouldn't be enough for people to say the whole internet is pissed off.
I see those kind of articles all the time where it's like, everybody is outraged. And then they share a bunch of random tweets from people who are either being trolls or some people that maybe are legitimately upset. And you're just like, well, that's just a small fraction. Like, you're just finding who you want on social media just to fit your agenda. I'm sure you can find plenty of people like, dude, that's awesome that The Rock and Oprah donated all that money.
And yeah, it's not a story at all if the really extreme, extreme minority says something. And like you said, Steve, any random moron can say what they want. It's like, well, who is this person you're quoting? Are they just Jimmy sitting on their couch?
Yep.
It's like, that's not enough to actually, like, I want facts. Well, what am I, crazy? What do I want facts for?
But where are the facts on this? There are no facts. It's just an opinion. You think the Rock and Oprah are being decent people for donating any money and millions of dollars? I'm sure the people of Maui are going to be very appreciative to get millions of dollars. Or you can find the people like they could have donated more. And those are usually the people who have donated nothing.
See, the facts would be how many people feel that way, one way or the other. That's what I'm talking about. And going to one person doesn't tell you either or. Therefore, the story is stupid. Mm-hmm. It's like, I have no idea how many people care or don't care about what The Rock and Oprah have done. I know that they live, well, I know Oprah has a house house in a very nice house in Hawaii, and I think the Rock does too. So of course they're interested in helping out the community they live in, and I think I would be disingenuous if I just said there's something wrong with them for asking people to give money. Why is there something wrong with that? Even if they got a ton of money, it's still nice to ask people, hey, if you can help, please help. If you don't want to help, don't help.
Right, one person's like, The Rock and Oprah asking money from us poor people was pathetic. Well, then you don't have to donate. Like, yeah. if you can't afford it, I'm sure the Rock's not going to knock on your door. That would be awesome if he knocked on my door. Like, when are you donating? But if you can donate, then that's even more money on top of whatever money they donate. Sometimes people get mad at the celebrities because they're not donating enough. And I'm like, well, the fact that they're donating and they're sending money, I think the people who are on the receiving end of that money appreciate it.
Yeah, I think there's a rich people backlash in the world. That's the problem. I think that's, and unfortunately, Oprah and The Rock are basically, because they're famous, they're taking a lot of heat for the fact that many people are getting effed over by rich people and like super rich people. You're like, why do you need all this money and I have to lose my job and you're ruining companies?
Sure, people are on edge.
Yeah, and unfortunately, The Rock and Oprah are just like, hey, I mean, you know, I as much as I hate The Rock, you know, it's a joke hate, I just can't get on him for this. No. I really can't. And I have said before, sure, Oprah's money, the amount of money that she gives, if she gives $5 million, if you really break down the math of it based on how much she has in her net worth compared to what you and I might have in our net worth, and me, it could be anything any given day for me.
1.4 million today.
Oh, I'm back
what
up to 1.4 million.
F, man.
Yeah, baby. I'm back, kind of. I was at 20 million, though, Danny. I'm still so far down.
Well, you were at 3 million this morning, but I just double-checked.
Jeez, I went down. I wiped down a million and a half just doing nothing.
Negative, Nancy. At one point, you were at 300,000. I know. You should celebrate the triumphs in life where you've been able to turn your life around and get back into the seven-figure world.
See, that's why I can't donate to Maui. I just never know what's going to happen.
In comparison, Oprah's at 2.5 billion, and The Rock is at 800 million.
Okay. Oh, see, he can't give him a hard time. But he's not even a billionaire.
Can anybody do math real quick?
No.
Can
no,
you tell me not what the percentage is of 2.5 billion that 5 million is? It would be like if you made $50,000 a year and probably gave a donation of like 250
sure
bucks.
I understand that. But tell whoever it is, let's just say we're donating to the Danny V Society of Sad Children. And you're like, "Hey, would you like $5 million?" Or would you like $250? They're going to be happy to get $5 million. Who cares who it's coming from and how much money that person makes for a living?
Yeah. It's just that at the other side of it, though, it's not that big of a stretch for Oprah to be able to do that. That's all. It's not a big sacrifice for her.
I don't care if it's a sacrifice or not. She's still being generous.
That's why people are mad. They're like, well,
people need to stop being mad.
Yeah, well, I mean, people I think are mad because they're struggling. I mean, you know, they're struggling to make ends meet, and they're taking it all out on Oprah. And that's the tough one.
You know what? Host your own television show and get your own magazine and make a lot of money. I'm kidding.
Yeah.
I know that's not that easier said than done.
Yeah, it's just a backlash against the super rich. And I don't think The Rock and Oprah deserve it. But there is something to be said, though, about the fact that there's no middle class anymore. It's just poor people and rich people, it seems. Mm-hmm. And that is a problem. And I don't know why rich people don't get that and figure that out and somehow, you know, figure out a way to maybe redistribute the wealth on your own rather than have some governmental agency force you to do it. That just is dumb because you need people to do the jobs or your money means nothing. So happy people are a lot better than upset people.
I like this text that just says, can't The Rock be like other normal famous people and make a TikTok video of him singing Imagine?
You're yeah, right. Exactly.
You're right. How dare he donate money? He should be singing Imagine, damn it.
I will say I am impressed with The Rock. He did not at least get Terramana in either one of those videos.
It wasn't, okay, he was driving, so he wasn't drinking his Terramana. He wasn't even drinking his Zoa energy drink.
Yeah.
Which I saw this weekend when I was at the store. I almost took a picture and just sent it to our group chat just to troll you, BJ.
Here's the problem. I know that with the way Hollywood goes now, there are actors that say that for them to get roles, it's based on how many followers they have now. Like, it's not even based on talent anymore. If it's like an actor who's as talented as another actor, but that one actor has more followers, they'll get the role. It's kind of hard for me to even argue with The Rock always being on social media and always being engaged. It helps him get the... I hate
one of the biggest stars in Hollywood.
I hate it, but he is doing everything you're supposed to, but I'm just tired of it. I'm like, this is not...
You know how you could be less tired of it?
Yeah.
You just unfollow him.
I don't follow him anyway. It's because of you people. I never know about anything.
Well, then I can't help you with that. We're gonna keep bringing him.
Yeah,
up.
You keep trolling the hell out of me. Like, I want to know about The Rock and him saying hi to people.
Maybe embrace him, and then we won't bring it up because now we know we can't troll you with it.
Yeah, well,
it's time for you to join the dark side.
It's not gonna happen. I'm never gonna embrace The Rock. I mean, it's all about family. I'm with Dom.
Become a different rockaholic.
Sorry, I'm all about Dom. And I don't even know why.
Who the hell's Dom?
Dom from Fast and Furious. It's all about family. Yeah, Steve. Come on, Steve. Come on. It's a big rivalry. They hate each other. Sort of.
Okay. I'm not really up on my Fast and the Furious. I got to get back on it.
Oh, yeah. Well, that was the big drama is that supposedly Vin Diesel and Rock don't get
I don't know which Fast and the Furious movies I've watched.
You've watched really the ones with the cars.
Back. You really need to get back on and watch the first one.
Go back and start with the beginning.
And that's it. That's all you need to watch.
Oh, don't listen to Danny.
The Rock's not in it. I'm not watching the first one.
Danny doesn't like all the bells and whistles. He says, can we just go back to when they were racing? No. Yeah, exactly. They got to drive cars in space or it's not real.
Cars in space.
Okay. Otherwise, it's not real, Danny. All right, there's this video going viral on the TikTok.
Okay.
I don't know about that. Where a guy is teaching people to use painter's tape on the bottom of shoes they bought so they can return it the next day after wearing them. Oh, yeah, because you scuff up those bottoms, and that's why it's really hard to try to return them and go, I didn't wear these.
This is one of life's dumb stresses, though, is when you get brand new shoes and you're not sure if they fit right. But like, you bought them at the store, and they fit okay in the store, but then like, you know, you got them on, you're like, do I dare step outside? Because once I step outside, these are mine.
Yes.
You know, and I'll walk around my house sometimes. I don't know if you guys do that, but like, I'll put, like, if I get a new pair of Nikes, I'm like, ah, man, they feel a little weird. I'll just wear them around the house just for a little bit just to see if they're okay. That way I don't scuff up the bottom of the shoes.
Yeah, good call. Yeah, so here's this hack that he has. I think a lot of women definitely can appreciate this because, you know, you want to buy some expensive shoes to look good, but, you know, do you have the money to buy those expensive shoes, Carrie? Well, we'll find out.
You want to grab a pair of shoes from your favorite store. You will need something called painter's tape. You can get this at any hardware store or online. Next thing you want to do is take the shoes and cover the entire bottom surface with the tape. After you're done, remove the painter's tape off the shoe and boom, fresh like they just came out the stove. Wrap them back in a box and baby, take them back to the stove.
Wow, man.
Could you imagine if you're somewhere and like you're hanging out with somebody and like, they cross their legs and then all of a sudden you see the bottom of their shoe?
Yeah,
and,
like, it's sitting, like, what?
And you're like, you know, like, that, what is it, the fancy shoes have the red bottoms?
Oh, yeah.
Like
the Louboutin.
Like, it's just like, oh, is this a new thing? It's like the blue bottom shoes? And you're like, no, that's just painter's tape. I'm like, what are you doing, man?
Yeah, I'll tell you what I'm doing. Saving bank, brother. I have new shoes every week.
Have you ever done that? Have you ever bought clothes knowing full well you're going to return them?
No.
I have not, but we used to work with a guy that did that all the time.
Yes. And they would hide the tag, and then they would wear them. It's like a nice suit, and then return. And I wouldn't want to deal with that stress. I'm a slob. I'm always, when I eat, I don't care what it is. I'm going to get it on me.
That's fair. My aunt used to do that all the time, and she would go, like, binge shopping. Like, all the stores. She'd spend a whole day Saturday, and then you'd go into her closet, and she just had, and it's like, why do all these still have tags on them? Oh, I'm going to take them back. But after I wear them one time.
I couldn't do that. Like, if I can't afford it, I'm not buying it.
Yeah.
And you know, stores like
Nordstrom. If I can, I'll put it on my credit card and you know, deal with payments forever. I'm still not buying.
I wonder what stores like, because Nordstrom has to know that this happens, because Nordstrom takes everything back.
Yes.
And I know
Costco
that,
too.
Yeah. And that was the offender, the person that we knew. You know, Costco's a good place, but I mean, Nordstrom's got the clothes, you know. And so if you want to look good, you go to Nordstrom, do the move. And if you're somebody that, like me, you stole your gun from like the TJ Maxx you worked from all those years ago.
Uh-huh.
So I had the gun that could put stuff back on.
Oh, yeah.
So you could even cut the tags off and put them back on again.
I mean, it's easy to buy those on Amazon.
Oh, you could get them now. Oh, look at that. You don't have to steal them anymore.
When we were at the radio convention in Dallas, I saw a dude had a shirt on with the tag on it. And my first thought was, oh, is he just going to go return this?
Yeah.
And then I realized, no, it's a T-shirt. And I'm like, I never got close enough to him. And I didn't want to embarrass him. But he still had his tag on his T-shirt. And I was like, what's this guy doing? Like, you got to take the tag off. And then so I'm like, trying to see it, and I like took a picture, not to share it. I wasn't doing it to like shame the guy, but I was like trying to zoom in to see, and there's like $1.99. I'm like, how did this guy get a shirt for $1.99?
That's a sweet deal.
That is impressive. No wonder
that's why he's keeping the tag on.
But I don't know if he knew. And like,
he did. They were doing a whole bit.
Was it a bit?
Yeah.
I had a feeling it was a bit.
You weren't even in on it.
But I wanted to go up to him and be like, hey, bro, You still got your tag on your T-shirt.
So, Danny, what was the bit? What were they trying to
see
do?
See if people would tell them?
No, it's something I don't remember. They tried to explain it at one of our the panels that we go to, and it's basically they were wearing retro clothes or thrift store clothes for a week or something like that.
Oh, okay.
And they were I think they were taking donations for doing that.
So it's something like that. Okay. I was like, man, are they not paying this guy enough that he can't he had to get a $1.99 T-shirt?
Yeah, right.
And he's wearing it one of our events, like one of the cocktail hour things. Couldn't get close enough to him because I wanted to be like, finally I saw him later on, but he had to tag off or he had a different shirt. And I'm like, I didn't know his name. And his name, yeah, dude, also like.
His name was Thrifty, of course.
No, we all have our stupid radio names. But like, I'm like, hey, man, I'm Steve. Nice to meet you. He goes, hi, I'm Meat Hammer or whatever it was.
I remember Meat Hammer.
I'm like.
Is that his porn name?
I'm like, what's your real name, man? Like, you know, like, come up and say, hey, man, I'm Meat Hammer. And so I'm supposed to like, hey, Meat Hammer, you want a drink?
That's a tough one. I mean, I get it, but then we all have our little tags, and that's what it said on his tag, Meat Hammer. So what do you, I mean, but I'm with you. It's weird. Like, can I call you MH? Can I give you something else?
I just kind of want to, like, get past that. Like, come on. That's your stage name. I get it.
Yeah.
Meat Hammer. And don't get me wrong. I get a dance from a girl. If her name was Meat Hammer, like, that's impressive.
That's awesome. You know, I'm with you, dude. I know that guy you're talking about. And I was like, I don't want to call you that.
I was like, for the rest of the time, I was like, I just can't address you as Meat Hammer. I'm sorry. I'm not going to be like, dude, Meat Hammer, what are you doing tonight?
What's up, MH? I might MH him and that's it. I'm not even Meat Hammering him, but you're right. It is. I don't know when you are like, when is your name stupid enough that you just say, okay, my name is Jimmy?
Your name is Meat Hammer.
Or put it in quotations, Meat Hammer, then put like Jimmy or something in there. Just so that, I mean, we're all working. It's like, I get if you were at a listener event or something, but we're all workmates.
No, it wasn't. Now I'm remembering. He didn't even say his name. It was like his host.
Of course,
introduced him to me.
Yeah, that's not a good way to do it.
As Meat Hammer, and I'm like, blink twice if you're okay with this is your name. Like, you know, like he just kind of like looked like, yep, I'm Meat Hammer. I'm like, nice meat.
Yeah, I wouldn't introduce him that way. And you know me, I had some horrible nicknames for all of our interns, but I would say their name.
You would be like, hey, this is my intern Mangina Matt.
No, I would say it's Matt.
Okay.
Yeah, I would do that.
So you're a man of integrity.
And part of their name was at least in their name. You know, Bend Over Ben, Mangina Matt, Mama's Boy Troy. At least their name was in there, right?
Fair.
You know, it's like I didn't change their name completely like the Meat Hammer, which, by the way, Meat Hammer is a great name. And I think
our other intern, Meat Sweats.
Vicky, is there a chance we could get you to change your name to Meat Hammer? We think that's a great name.
Yeah, sure.
There
as long
go.
As he doesn't get mad at me.
All right, there you go. Meat Hammer.
Because I have some Meat Hammer beef.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yesterday, Meat Hammer's biggest fan, Steve, got this one right.
Who co-starred alongside John Heder in the comedy Blades of Glory?
John Heder. John Heder, isn't it? Will Ferrell.
Yes.
He also goes by Meat Hammer.
Yes. You can tell that Sarah does not have the same care for getting name pronunciations right as I do. She does not care.
No, that definitely Apple didn't fall too far from the chair in this one.
Yeah. You want a shot at beating Steve? You got it. 206-803-ROCK. We're playing Beat Migs. We'll do that at 847 on The Rock.
Today's podcast was brought to you by Travis Gagne, bankruptcy attorney. He's here right now and has agreed to answer more of your questions about bankruptcy. Here's another question from a listener. I'm getting my wages garnished. Can bankruptcy help with that?
Absolutely. One of the big reasons people file bankruptcy is because they have a judgment or a lawsuit against them, or their wages are getting garnished, and so they can't pay their other regular ongoing bills. People sometimes think that you can't file bankruptcy once they have a judgment against them or once a garnishment has started, and that's not true. Filing bankruptcy will immediately stop any garnishment that you have going, except for child support, and stop your creditors from continuing on with garnishments of your bank accounts, your wages, and in most cases will discharge that liability through the bankruptcy process. And we can file a bankruptcy case for you usually the day you come in.
Thanks, Travis. If you have more questions about bankruptcy, you can reach out to Travis anytime at choosetherightchapter.com. That's choosetherightchapter.com. Thanks for listening.
Are you dealing with a personal injury? Don't go it alone. Turn to the experienced team at Phillips Law Firm. Their attorneys have helped thousands of clients get the compensation they deserve. Call Phillips Law Firm now. Call 1-800-JUSTICE or visit justiceforyou.com.
It's after bedtime, the kids are asleep, and the moms are out to play.
We're Dina and Kristen, the duo behind the Instagram account Big Little Feelings. I'm Dina. I'm a child therapist and mom of two who nerds out on all things neurobiology and psychology. And Kristen is a parent coach who wrangles three kids on a daily basis, here to give it to us like it is.
We weren't meant to do this parenting thing alone. Consider After Bedtime your village.
Follow After Bedtime with Big Little Feelings on the Odyssey app or wherever you get your podcasts.
Hey, this is BJ. Thanks for listening to our show's podcast. If you're a fan of all things geeky, you should check out my other podcast, BJ Shea's Geek Nation. We have new episodes every day, and you can check it out at bjgeeknation.com.
Your home is going into foreclosure, and you feel like a financial wreck. You don't know where to turn for accurate information. I'm bankruptcy attorney Travis Gagne. Let's talk about some legal options. If we work quickly, we can propose a plan to save your home, modify the loan, or in many cases, even eliminate your second mortgage. The consultation is free. I've helped hundreds of people just like you make informed decisions about whether to save their home or exit it on a reasonable, organized timeline. The chapter you choose sets the tone for the next chapter of your life. Please contact me today at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com.
99.9 KISW, the Rock of Seattle. It's our loud and local band of the week. It's Devaria. Listening to the loud and local band of the week, Devaria. You want to find out how to get their music? Steve will let you know.
I love that they just released a brand new record on September 1st, and what did they title it?
September.
So,
hey, I get that.
I don't know. They will get a new album October next month. I know. Actually, they just also put out a brand new remix of all the songs called September Lace. You can check it all out on Devaria's Bandcamp.
And you can go to the BJ and Migs page of KISW.com if you want to get more info. And you can tune in on Sunday nights here on The Rock. It's a show called Loud and Local. Oh, if you're loving the local music, you got 2 hours of it. Bands like Devaria.
Because we made it. It's Friday.
It's Friday.
Hey, look at Danny. He's jumping.
Yes, sir. That's DK Metcalf over there.
Friday. Oh, yeah. I always get those two confused because one is talented and one is Danny.
It's a beautiful blue Friday.
Yeah, can you believe it?
Oh.
Season starts.
It's crazy.
I don't like it, though. It's a lot of anticipation with the season. Last year, we didn't really, all we cared about was just beating the Broncos. But this year, we actually think we could be somebody. And, oh, I get a little worried about
we
that.
We know.
Yeah.
Yeah. Super Bowl or bust, BJ.
Yeah, you got Geno and DK in here today.
Like
all right?
I said yesterday, as Geno Smith, I'm going to lead this team to a 13-4 season.
I promise this. I promise this. I will start betting against Mitch. We'll have Mitch Levy on Monday. I will start betting breakfast against him so that your Seahawks can win.
Oh. Nice.
And this Sunday, we're thinking a win for sure, right?
Big win.
Yeah.
Huge win.
It would be, look, they don't have Cooper Kupp. And we're supposed to be so much better than the Rams. It would definitely be a nice statement game if we went out there and we really handily beat those Rams. But I'll take any kind of W.
Absolutely. Same. Let's get to our contestant. We have Travis from Texas today. Travis, are you there?
I am.
All right, Steve, now get out of here.
Goodbye.
For those playing at home.
Seattle versus Texas. This is perfect because that's in baseball. We're doing it. We're going after both those damn teams.
Travis, you have 60 seconds to answer 10 questions. You can pass all you want, but you will only get 3 guesses per question. Are you ready?
Go Hawks and go Mariners.
Yeah. Same name as a type of footwear. What is the name of the monkey in the children's show Dora the Explorer?
Pass.
What beverage is the official state drink of 20 U.S. states?
Coca-Cola.
No.
Pepsi.
No.
Ginger ale.
No. Oh. The CDC categorizes a chronic disease as lasting at least how long?
10 years.
No.
5 years.
No.
7 years.
No. Fair. Lima is the capital of what South American country?
Belize?
No.
Argentina?
No.
Brazil?
No. In the mathematical acronym PEMDAS, what operation does P stand for?
Parentheses.
Yes. William James Adams Jr. is better known as what Black Eyed Peas singer?
Pass.
In 2000, Greg Glassman co-founded what strength and conditioning program?
T90X.
No.
Wow.
Wow, Travis is right. You got one correct.
Oh, that is not a performance.
No,
we had not a performance at all.
We had a 10 for earlier. This one here, the exact opposite.
It is the exact opposite.
Damn, that's a crit miss if you're a D&D.
Yeah.
Man.
I want to have faith, but it's a little hard to. Yeah. Steve, are you ready?
Oh, yeah.
Same name as a type of footwear. What is the name of the monkey in the children's show Dora the Explorer?
A sneaker?
No.
Nike?
No.
Nike.
Sandals?
No.
Good call.
What beverage is the official state drink of 20 U.S. states?
A beverage? Coca-Cola?
No.
Iced tea?
No.
Pepsi?
No. The CDC categorizes a chronic disease as lasting at least how long?
3 days.
No.
3 days.
A year.
Yes.
There we go.
Lima is the capital of what South American country?
Peru.
Yes.
Peru.
In the mathematical acronym PEMDAS, what operation does the P stand for?
Pencil.
No.
Prime.
No.
Peter.
No. William James Adams Jr. is better known as what Black Eyed Peas singer?
Fergie.
No.
Will I am.
Yes. In 2000, Greg Glassman co-founded what strength and conditioning program?
CrossFit.
Yes. Including the punchline, a typical knock-knock joke is how many lines?
4.
No.
5.
Yes. In sports, WOSO is short for women's what?
Women sit out.
No.
Women up to super onion.
Danny, do you know?
No.
Oh, what?
I don't know WOSO.
Something with
soccer. Women's
soccer.
Yeah. It's women's soccer. What do you mean?
Soccer?
Something with soccer and you don't guess soccer?
WOSO.
Jeez.
See, I thought it was 4 different words.
Right. Same,
I
suck. Man.
Yeah, I suck.
Same.
Well, it doesn't matter because you got 5 correct, which is a win 5-1.
Big sorry, man. Travis.
That's all right. It happens.
There you go. But at least Travis is listening in Texas. That's nice.
I'm this.
Woo! On the Odyssey app, by the way, Travis is listening. A-U-D-A-C-Y.
Okay, Vicky. I know you're going to know this one. Same name as the type of footwear. What is the name of the monkey in the children's show Dora the Explorer?
Boots.
Yes.
Oh,
dude. That's right. Yeah. Our governor back in the day, the old governor.
Boots.
Her husband was Boots the Monkey.
Christine Gregoire's husband was Boots. You're right. Oh, that's bad that we forgot that.
Dude, I've never watched an episode of Dora the Explorer.
Really?
No.
I wonder when or if Tatum's going to get into that.
Maybe never, because is it beyond her now?
It could be.
I don't know, man. Every once in a while, like, she'll sit and watch Pokemon. I'm like, aren't you a little too old for this crap?
Yeah, come on.
I'm like, what
Dora's,
are we doing here?
Dora's like older school, sort of like, would you ever expect her to watch a Barney show? But
it's
I don't.
2 to 5.
2 to 5.
Well, I don't mean that. I mean, like, it's older in a generation, whereas there's new, like, Paw Patrol wasn't around when Dora was around.
Yeah, right now, it's just Paw Patrol.
Yeah, so, I mean, Dora was cool, but you know how it goes, man. You get a generation of kids, and then the new generation comes in, they want nothing to do with it.
Is Bluey done? For it with you guys?
Know what it is? Whenever we try and put Bluey on, she's just like, nah, I'm not feeling it.
Yep.
But then, like, sometimes we'll watch stuff on YouTube, Paw Patrol toys on YouTube. That's her favorite thing to do. And when an episode ends, it'll, like, instantly, like, you know how it, like, just starts playing something else?
Sure.
And sometimes they'll just play an episode of Bluey, and she'll sit and watch it and howl laugh. Like, she thinks it's the funniest thing, and we're like, getting this out of the mind of a toddler. I mean, this is the same kid that, like, well, like, you want to take a bath? No! Screaming and crying. And we put her in the bath. You want to get out of the bath? No! Yeah. I love it in the bath. I'm like, you are messing with my head.
Yeah, she is.
Yeah.
Yeah, she is.
Same as, like, knock-knock jokes. We were trying to do that with her yesterday, actually.
Oh, really?
Night, like, trying to make it happen. And every time it's like, knock-knock, and she just looks at us, and then we go, who's there? And then she goes, Tatum.
No.
Kim,
yeah, the kids troll him.
And then she
out
thinks
you
that's so funny.
I mean, yeah, I think she does. Yeah.
Right?
She's like, I'm smarter than you two idiots.
Yeah, I really want that on video, by the way. Yeah.
All right, I'll work on that tonight.
Because that is hysterical. She is trolling the hell out of you two.
Right?
That kid, I'm telling you, they say that kids are just manipulating you a lot earlier than you ever realize. I feel like probably day three, she had both of you just under the manipulation train.
There are many times where I'm watching how she is with mom, with Sid, and I'm positive she is just trolling her because like Sid's getting frustrated about something, and Tatum just keeps doing it. And I'm like, you are just laying it in thick. This is hilarious.
See, that's the thing. Joey was a troller. Sarah and I, we were similar, so she at least would go at it, but I knew she legitimately was engaged. Joey, on the other hand, never had any, all he wanted to do was troll. Yep. So, and that's kind of his mom. His mom is just like, I don't need to be a bother with you people. I'll just troll you. And so I'm wondering what your kid's going to be.
100% troll.
Okay, so that's
no doubt.
So your poor wife.
Yeah.
Oh, your poor wife.
And then the knucklehead dad over here is laughing at the whole thing.
Well, yeah. Where's the troll come from? The troll tree.
Very true.
Yeah.
That's probably why she does it even more.
I'm very proud of her, actually.
Yeah. And she knows that. So she's like, I'm going to make dad even more proud and piss mom off.
Oh, yeah. That's not going to be good.
Going back to the game real quick. What beverage is the official state drink of 20 U.S. states?
I'll say coffee.
Vodka.
No, I wish. No, and I actually kind of think this is gross. Vicky, you still drink it all the time.
Milk. Oh,
milk.
Yep.
Milk. Really? 20 states are still saying that's their official beverage.
Milk was a bad choice.
All of us got really disgusted with that.
Just drinking a whole glass of milk sounds so nice.
Unless you're pouring it in a coffee or using it to make mashed potatoes. I really don't.
Yeah, I haven't had a glass of milk in forever. And I have a friend of mine. He takes cake and he puts his cake in a bowl of milk. Okay. Have you ever heard of that?
Why are you ruining the cake like that?
Any kind of birthday cake, chocolate cake, that's a thing. And it's not just him. He's got everybody doing that.
Yeah. It makes me think of like Iglesias does a whole joke about the chocolate cake shakes they do in Chicago. It's just milkshake of an actual slice of cake.
See, I can't see if that's the case. And if that's somebody that is, I can't argue with that. But
that sounds amazing.
And he loves milk with everything. And I look at him and go, what the hell is wrong with you, Pally?
No, only in my cereal. That's it.
I haven't had cereal in forever, so I don't even do milk there.
But it was a time like in my 20s, I had a big ass glass of milk, I would just chug it down.
Yeah, but then you got vodka.
That's true.
It's much better. You know what? Lucky Charms with vodka, come on.
Make better decisions with it.
Yeah. All right, it's time for Listeners on the Loose. This is where you pick the topic, you guide the show. Call us or text us at 206-803-ROCK, and we'll take those calls. We'll take those texts at 917 on The Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9
KISW. 99.9 KISW, The Rock of Seattle. It's Listeners on the Loose, brought to you by Kia of Puyallup. Listeners on the Loose, 206-803-ROCK, the number to call, the number to text. If you get through, make sure you follow Steve's rule.
It's a simple rule, BJ, show some energy and bring it. Otherwise, we're hitting that gong. And then we're saying goodbye to you.
Goodbye, old friend.
Listeners on the Loose, 206-803-ROCK, the number to call, the number to text.
Someone said the Kraken season is soon upon us. I can't believe that's next month.
Yes.
Crazy. And I can't wait. Well, Migs, the Kraken still don't have a captain. Do you think they're going to choose one this year? For me, the obvious choice, number 37, Yanni Gourde. But that's just me. What do you guys think from Shane and Chehalis?
Yeah, I mean, at this point, I haven't kept up with everyone that's left and everyone that's that got here, but I can't. I mean, Yanni is a good choice.
I would love to see Yanni Gourde. He's my favorite player on the team. I don't know. I mean, but you just don't know if that's like if that's the captain. You know what I mean? Like, there's a certain quality to being a captain.
Has a goalie ever been a captain?
No.
Oh, I'm trying to think. Yeah, I can't remember. But at the same time,
I think Luongo might have been like. It's almost like you're kind of our captain, but you're not. They don't typically put seeds on the goalies because of just. They don't play every game, and I think also just because of, like, they can't come out to meet up with the referees at, like, that certain little circle. There's more to it than I care to remember, to be honest with you, but I know goalies are never captains.
Yeah, I don't remember that either. Gruby definitely.
But he's not going to play every game, so you kind of want your captain to be playing the majority of the games, and he'll play maybe 50-ish games in the season as opposed to 80, 82.
And sometimes they do have co-captains. Has that happened?
No.
No? Oh, okay.
I haven't seen any cocaine. I mean, again, dude, you're asking me questions. I don't know for sure.
I don't know either.
I don't have an encyclopedia knowledge of, I love hockey, don't get me wrong, but I don't have an encyclopedia knowledge of all the history of captains. Typically, if you want more than one captain, you just let everybody wear the A. You have the multiple alternates.
Oh, there we go.
Kind of like how the Kraken did it last year, where you have everybody's kind of chipping in a sense, or three guys are chipping in a sense. I don't know if they're going to go with a captain. I mean, hell, the Vegas Golden Knights, they took years until they found themselves who they felt would be the captain. I wouldn't be surprised if someone like a Matty Beniers might be our next captain. Maybe not this season, but the following season when he's got a couple of years under him. And because he seems like he's already, in a sense, a leader in that team, with that team.
Yeah.
I think Vince Dunn, Jordan Eberle, there's a lot of good players.
I think for a Matty Beniers, he's got to have 3 years under his belt before he's a captain.
I would think so, too. Yeah. I mean, this is season number two.
Yeah.
I wouldn't be surprised if that's something that they're thinking about. Like, hey, maybe by season three, that's going to be our guy, and we'll just continue with the alternates.
Yeah, if I'm Matty, I don't want it now. I just feel like it's the wrong look. You know, it's just like J-Rod. I think that even, especially since J-Rod for the Mariners is now having a really good season because he had a tough time at the beginning of this year. Mm-hmm. I think now you look at J-Rod going, okay, I think we can call him the official leader because this is only a sophomore season. And the same thing for Matty. This will be his sophomore season. I don't think it's the right time. Maybe, like you said, next year. I could see year four because who knows if Yanni will be with us in year four of Matty Beniers' career, you know, where you might go, okay.
I'd be stoked if Yanni Gourde ends up being the captain. But there's a lot of good. Adam Larson's a really good. He seems to be a leader in the locker room. I mean, typically, it's not always that the best player is the captain. I mean, obviously, you have certain guys that are like your star player that are also the captain. I don't know if that's for political reasons. You don't want to piss the guy off. Or if they truly are a leader in the locker room.
And some people, like, they get that. Some really star players really get the fact that, oh, no, this person is the one that will probably be a manager someday, will be a head coach someday, because they just have that ability to lead and to inspire people of all play levels, people of all personality types. And that guy is valuable, you know, on the ice and in the locker room, that's for sure.
I almost want them to never have a captain. That way the story will always be that they had a captain and they traded him in the very first season that they had. Yeah. And they got rid of the captain with Mark Giordano.
Yeah.
And just let that be the forever, the Giordano curse.
He's the only captain we'll ever have.
We'll never have a captain again. They'll always just be alternates.
Yeah, I don't know if I want that C in my jersey, especially if I want to stay. You know what I mean? You're right. It's like the Madden curse. Do I want to be on the cover? I don't want to. No, never mind. Don't do it.
So Bobby Wagner's got, he was picked by, because I like how in football, like the team picks it, like the players. And I saw that Bobby Wagner's the captain for the defense.
Oh, it makes sense.
It does, but you know, still, like, he was gone for a year. You never know.
Yeah, you're right. And at the same time, it's like he was gone for a year, but it was one of those things where you're like, they still loved him. You know, everybody loved him. Even like when they came to visit, you could just see it was a love fest for Bobby whenever, you know, the Seahawks and the Rams played.
There was no Bobby Wagner slander. And it's so funny because he was gone the same day that Russell Wilson was, you know, traded. Remember, that was the same exact day. Like they released him on the same day.
One left for the money, one left because of money, but it wasn't his fault. It was
right.
And I'm excited because I feel like that's good. It's a blip. I don't want to see him in any other uniform. We're going to forget. We're going to forget that he wore it. And, of course, and he's taking on his whole team, which is super helpful because,
you know, he plays them just as hard as he played us last year.
Maybe he's got some clues on how to keep that Aaron Donald guy from being such a pain in our ass. That would be nice. You know what I mean? That really, I guess, triple team the guy. That's how you, that's the way you stop him from being a pain
just
in the ass.
Just sit on him for the entire game.
Yeah.
Find our heaviest player and sit on him.
Yeah, you know, I've been watching a lot of videos and watching a lot of predictions. You know, I never pay attention preseason. I don't. I mean, outside of Bobo, I don't know what the hell's going on. But now I'm starting to get into it again. So, of course, I'm doing a lot of reading and I'm watching a lot of videos. And, I mean, people are really, really, really loving the Hawks. They are predicted, like, they're the sixth team out of, like, the top six teams they think will go to the Super Bowl. We are in the top six.
I saw that the odds went down. Like, it was like, oh, my goodness. Like, there's some actual outside belief outside of Seattle and outside of my crazy noggin that there's some people that believe that they could go pretty far.
Yeah. They feel like our offense is just going to be insane. That's what a lot of people feel like. And then the defense is going to be a wild card, depending upon whether or not Adams can stay healthy. And that, you know, but we've got some good, we got a good young secondary, and they're excited about some of the people that we have on defense. But the offense, they're like, that's the powerhouse, which is, again, not what Pete Carroll really, like, that's not what Pete Carroll is all about. That's why getting Njigma was really something. And if he does start, which is, how funny is this? Enigma basically hurts himself. He might start before Jamal Adams starts. And I mean, it's such a weird thing when you think about it.
Yeah, different body parts, obviously. But yeah, dude, it's crazy. He got injured, gets surgery 2 weeks later. And everyone's thinking maybe week three at the earliest. And here he is going to be part of the team on week one.
Yeah, so.
Lumenfield's going to be rocking on Sunday.
Yeah.
Kind of want to go.
It's exciting. And
but I don't want to spend that kind of money.
You know, that's the only time I get it. I've been to Hawks games. They're exciting. But, man, there's no better seat than your living room sometimes. It really isn't.
I don't disagree with you, but there's no better experience than the opening game of the season to be there with everybody screaming and yelling. And the weather's not going to be terrible, so you don't have to be freezing your footballs off. And you can just be having the best time.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Like, 9 times out of 10, actually, like, what, 16 times out of 17, I'd much rather watch the game at home on my couch. But there's always I want to go to at least one game a season.
Yeah, and you're right. This is the time to go because the weather and the opening game, sure.
That, and also there's a game in October that I think Danny and I are going to try and make.
Which one is this one?
Against the Cleveland Browns.
Oh, you're hoping to get a good deal on those tickets?
Well, that's nice. Yeah, that would be nice. because that's the vintage jersey night game.
Oh, the throwback.
So everyone's going to be wearing their throwback jerseys.
Yeah, you guys are ready for that.
Funny enough. Expect to see this every Friday, BJ. I dropped over $150 for this jersey.
Oh, that's legit. That's not your overseas version.
Look at it. It's beautiful.
It's perfect. It's hard to tell with the quality you get overseas.
This is one I bought at the team store.
Nice. Yeah. All right.
Okay. Right now, that's my faith in Gino right there.
There you go. Right now, the tickets for opening are cheaper than the Cleveland Browns game. I'm sure that will change, but...
Well, what are the tickets going for right now for the home opener?
$90.
What? Where are you, though? Are you, like, in the Hawks
level? Oh, 300 level for sure. Yeah.
That's why I like to sit anyway.
How much will it cost me for tickets if I watch it from T-Mobile Park? How many those tickets? Like, $20? Can I get those?
Somebody want to know, did you do your homework like Steve asked you to do and come up with a record on the team?
A record on the team.
Like, how are they going to do this year?
Well, I gave you a record yesterday.
That was a knee jerk. You didn't even put any
thought
in.
10-7. I actually put some thought in. I think 10-7 is a really good base.
Game by game to see whether you thought they were going to win.
No, I didn't do that.
Then you didn't do any research. You just came up with numbers.
All right, hold on. Number, yes, because you know what? I did look at the schedule way back in the day. Give me your schedule. What do you got?
No, I'll name off the team, win or lose. You got to be quick, Vicky. You keep talking.
Okay, here we go.
All right. Week one, Rams.
Win.
Okay, week two against the Lions.
I think that might be. Is it? Where is it?
That is, I believe, in Detroit.
Yeah. Okay. All right. You know, you don't have where it is. Then I'm gonna have to
quick
give it to
answers,
the,
man.
I'm gonna have to give it to the Lions if it's in Detroit. Tell me where it is because that does make a difference.
All right, fine. We gotta know. I gotta pull up the website. Okay. Week three against the Panthers.
Where is it?
Here.
That's here.
Okay. When?
Okay. Week then against the Giants.
It's at the
in
Giants.
New York.
I still am going to give it to us.
Okay, Bengals with super millionaire man.
And it's
Joe Burrow.
Yeah, I know.
Cincinnati.
It's at Cincinnati. That's a loss.
Okay, Cardinals here.
Win.
All right, Browns here.
Win.
Ravens there.
Oh, I think we can beat them. I'm going to say win on the Ravens.
Okay. Commanders here.
That should be a win.
Rams in stupid Los Angeles.
That should be a win.
Okay, 49ers here.
I'm going to say that's a win.
All right, Cowboys there.
That could be a loss.
49ers there.
Loss.
Eagles here.
The Eagles are not what they used to be from what I'm reading about. They had a lot of people leave. I'm going to say win.
Okay, Titans there.
I know nothing about the Titans, so
nobody in Tennessee does either.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm just going to say, for the sake of it, I'm going to say loss just to get to 10-7.
Oh, no, you don't do that.
Wow.
That's a scummy move.
I don't know anything about the Titans, but now it's at that place.
You're playing games with me, man.
Hey, dude, you said knee jerk. Right, that's my knee jerk.
Here.
That's got to be a win.
All right, Cardinals there.
Ooh, that's a win.
All right, what do we got? What's BJ's record?
I think it's 12. 1, 2, 3.
Is it 12?
5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12.
Yep. 12 wins.
All right.
12-5.
I will
BJ.
Say
that's
this.
Not 10-7.
Here's the thing, though. I got Niners at home, which I'm a little worried about, and Eagles at home. So that's why I would go 10-7.
Nope. You said 12-5. We went.
I will stand by 10-7.
Yeah. BJ said, no, because no,
you didn't do it. You just did your stupid knee jerk?
Yeah, that's how we do this.
Okay, well, see, I don't like that. I like to have some thought put into it, not just...
You put zero thought into 10 and 7.
No, I didn't.
You put way more thought into my knee-jerk way of doing things.
All right,
look. And you jerked it to 12 and 5.
I will say this. 12. That's the only time I ever jerk it is 12 and 5. What do you want from me? All right, look, I will stand behind 12 and 5, I think, is their maximum. That's their ceiling. I'm going to take that as a ceiling.
That's the record.
And here's why. Because I think the Niners and the Eagles could be tough. I don't know where to go on those.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, that could be tough
games. But isn't that interesting? You just assumed they go 10 and 7, but now you went game by game, and here we are, 12 and 5.
Yeah, it's because, you know, I mean, you gave me a knee jerk, and I mean, we're at home for
some
of those
games.
And
you looked at me like I was crazy. My record on the whole same way of doing it was 13 and 4.
Yeah, but you didn't put any thought into it.
Yeah, I did. I looked at the names of the teams, and I decided whether or not I think we could beat them.
Okay, you need to have, based on colors, because this was a tradition that I've done with Sarah back in the day. She would just, I have her pick football teams based on her favorite colors.
Uh-huh.
You should have Tatum do that and see how her record is compared to ours.
Okay, I'll go through the season with her over the weekend.
I like that.
That would be fun, because okay. I really...
Before the game on Sunday, we'll get Tatum's knee-jerk reactions.
Sarah had a better record than some of the ESPN and analysis... whatever they are, analysts.
Analysts.
Yeah, the analysts. She had a better record than the analysts way back in the day when she was a toddler.
Problem with Tatum is because we did this during the Kraken season. Like, she doesn't keep tabs with that they change jersey colors. So she just assumes they're the blue team, so she's rooting for them. But then we would go play and we'd be wearing our white jerseys against a team that's wearing their blue, like the City Edmonton Oilers or something like that.
You gotta show her helmets.
Yeah, show her helmets or the logo.
But, ooh,
dude, we're asking a lot out of a not even 4-year-old. I mean, she's
I feel like we're asking a lot out of her father, to be honest with you.
It's a combo platter. Yeah.
We're asking her father to sit there and try to order. He'd rather just pick these. Like, come on, he might get frustrated.
I'm
by
just
the time.
Like, no, this time we root for the team that's wearing white. No, Daddy, go blue.
Yeah, I can't blame her. It's very confusing, and you know, she's like, I thought we liked blue. What's happening here? Yeah, I can't blame her. So that's why you got to show her the helmet. What color helmet you like?
With hockey?
No, with football.
Oh, okay.
Show her the football helmet.
Well, I don't have every helmet in my house.
You have it. They show it in every schedule. They have helmet-to-helmet matchups usually, don't they?
See, you just print out each one, and then you just hold it up.
Why am I?
Don't have a printer in my house.
Okay.
Vicky, print this out for
you. You can show it on, literally, there's a Google. There's an internet. Come on.
There's a Google.
I mean, I even think the Seahawks schedule on their way. Yeah, look at this. Oh, no, it shows logos, though. Okay.
Ah, who's smart now?
Ah, now we have the football predicting goat chiming in. All right, I am done with this. All I know is I do not want to be held to 12 and 4.
You are.
I think 10 and 7 is 12 and 5. Okay.
Yeah. Be a man of what you said.
I feel like 12 and 5 is very doable, but I mean, you know, you don't know what's going to happen with injuries. Jamal Adams again, I'm worried about him. Like, will he play a half a game again? I mean, I don't know.
I bet he'll make it at least 4 quarters this year.
You know what? Yes. And that will be a step up, baby. You pick the topic, you guide the show. It is Listeners on the Loose. You can call us or text us at 206-803-ROCK. Your calls or texts at 936 on the Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on the Rock, 99.9 KISW.
99.9 KISW, the Rock of Seattle. It's Listeners on the Loose. You pick the topic, you guide the show. 206-803-ROCK, the number to call, the number to text.
Somebody wanted to know if did Danny eat the sardines yet? They had them as a sample at Costco in Silver Lake yesterday.
I forgot about that.
Yep.
What are the odds that we're talking about sardines, which isn't like, you know, like a thing that gets brought up a lot, and then that same day at Costco, they have it as a sample? I think Costco's listening to us.
Ooh. Well, they know good radio when they hear it.
Yep. Well, shout out to you, Costco. Tatum loves your samples. So does Dad.
Yeah.
I'm excited about that, because maybe I'll go to Issaquah then and see what they got going on.
I have not eaten sardines yet.
What?
I plan on bringing them in next week when I go to the store.
I thought today was the day I was going to join you.
Oh, were you?
Oh, my ass, you were.
I never complained about sardines. My dad, he grew up having them.
Would you have a cracker with sardines on it today?
What, a little sardine with a saltine? Yes.
Okay. And a hot sauce?
No, I'm not going to do hot sauce.
Okay, come on.
What do you mean, come on? That's not how I had them growing up.
They said that's the way you eat them, with hot sauce.
That's not how my dad ate them. He just ate them the way he ate them, man. Just sardines and salt.
Ate them the way he ate them.
That's how he did it. Yeah. Oh, yeah, definitely.
Speaking of food, someone said, Migs, I saw your Instagram story. How did you and Tatum like Moto Pizza? Oh, it was amazing.
Yes. Oh, right. Yeah. So you picked it up yesterday?
Picked it up on Wednesday, but then, you know, I picked it up. It was already past dinner when I picked it up, so then the next day we reheated. Now, honestly, I'm a fan of reheating pizza. Sometimes I think it even tastes better the second day.
Yeah, I've never had an opportunity. Well, actually, I shouldn't say that. I did have an opportunity, but it was day old, way day old, and I don't know. I liked the, I liked the fresh when I got in the ballpark better than
Don't get twisted on. Yeah. You know, when I picked it up, of course, I had to have a slice on my way home.
Oh!
I had a slice, but the rest of the family didn't until the next day.
So let me ask you then.
Uh-huh.
Fresh, reheat, with Moto. I mean, with regular pizza, yeah, does it make a difference?
Equal.
Okay, that's fair.
Honestly, no difference in taste. I might even like it better the next day, kind of like how I like spaghetti. Sometimes it tastes better when everything settles a little bit more. But either way, it was fantastic.
Yeah, maybe because Vicky's was sitting in the car for a while.
In a stinky car.
Yeah.
Joe's car.
Yeah, so maybe that's not that. Because I definitely like the fresh version that I got.
But we got the KISSD one, which is the name of it, KISSD. And yeah. It's like the hot honey.
Yeah.
Like the spicy honey.
Yeah. It's good.
So good.
Was it?
Yeah, it wasn't. Yeah. You barely even notice it, but every once in a while you get a little bit of a zing. And it was awesome.
I've seen pizzas that have the spicy honey, and it's turned me off just because I'm not a big sweet fan. But I was wondering, I wanted to hear like a review because it sounds like it could be good.
It's so minimal as far as flavor. It's not over the top that it's almost no different than having like a pepperoni.
Nice.
It's kind of on the same, because we also got the pepperoni one.
Yeah.
Pepperoni. So auto good. Pizza.
Oh, it's fantastic.
Yeah.
So good. Tatum loves it.
Well, that's good.
Yeah.
That's embarrassing if all of a sudden she didn't. They'd be like, okay, I'm going to have to get a new kid.
Yeah, kind of. Not stopping with the pizza, that's for sure.
Yeah. It is Listeners on the Loose, 206-803-ROCK, the number to call, the number to text.
So I said earlier this week, you guys were talking about your favorite one-hit wonders. Now I want to ask, what's your guys' favorite cover song? My new favorite is Linkin Park's cover of Adele's Rolling in the Deep. Man, Chester knocks that one out of the park.
Is that new?
I don't think it's new because he's no longer with us.
Oh, you know what? I thought you said Limp Bizkit. I'm losing my mind.
He said Linkin Park. It's his new favorite.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. I was like, Limp Bizkit did a cover of, but you said Linkin Park.
I mean, I wouldn't be surprised. Limp Bizkit covered Wham, or George Michael. So I wouldn't be surprised if they did that. But
a cover song done by somebody else. Ooh.
Well, if it's a cover song, it is done by somebody else.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you for I'm being very redundant.
I think Johnny Cash's Hurt might be my all-time favorite. Yeah. You really can't. I mean, anytime you could do a cover and it's better than the original, you got to give credit. And I love Nine Inch Nails' version, obviously their original version of Hurt, but Johnny took it to a whole other level with that version. It's so well done.
Yeah, you know, there are covers that you don't know are covers because they were big hits better than the band stuff.
There are some Kiss songs that I always thought were a Kiss song. Like the God gave Rock and Roll to You. I was like, oh, it's a Kiss song. It's a super cheesy, dumb Kiss song, and I love it. But I didn't know that it was a cover by somebody else.
Yeah, I'm going to go old school.
Uh-oh. Yeah. You want Sound of Silence by Disturbed, aren't you?
Look, that is a great version of the song, but it's so depressing.
Yes.
I mean, and the original song also is, you know, it's folky depressing, whereas, you know, Sound of Silence is definitely rock depressing. But for me, it's a classic that I think was so much better than the original only because of the fact that the band was just more, you know, more popular, but it's Surfing USA. And it's a cover based on the music, not the lyrics. They changed the lyrics, but the beat and everything is the same. It was Chuck Berry's Sweet Little 16. But it's one of their arguably one of their biggest songs, Surfing USA. Mm-hmm. And that is a cover, if you will. I mean, the whole music is all Chuck Berry's.
Man.
So that's I would say that's still one of my favorites because it's a great tune.
What's it, the Ataris? Do
Boys of Summer.
Boys of Summer. Oh, that's a great cover.
That's a good one.
Yeah.
I always get fired up when I'm like, I'll listen to some random playlist, and it always seems to show up on any playlist that I pull up. And I'm always like, man, this song kicks ass.
It does, but I'm just such a guy that gets pissed off. Like, that was Don Henley's song, and his version was good. But I can't argue with you, but I still want to be pissed off.
Why does that make you
it.
Mad?
I don't know. It's probably because who are these punk kids taking this song and doing with it.
I mean, the punk 45-year-olds nowadays.
Yeah, I know, right?
Well, back when it came out, right?
I mean, the guitarist is a grandparent now.
Yeah. You're right. Sure. You're absolutely right, dude. No, you're right, though. I mean, it was... What was it? Is that song 20 years old?
No, it came out in 2004.
It's 19 years old.
Yeah.
Okay, sorry. Did him up.
I keep thinking that...
It's 20 years old soon. Yeah, that's how old that is. You're old, Danny.
Yeah, I am.
Yeah.
I always love, like, Typo Negative used to, they're like kind of a sludgy, slow metal band, and they're from Brooklyn, and we were all obsessed with them growing up. And they would always do, like, Summer Breeze, they did a cover of.
Oh, wow.
And they would do some other, like, random covers that were just like, oh, man, these are just heavy and dark.
Did you ever hear there's a band called The Day to Remember. I know you know them, Steve. Yeah. But they covered Since You've Been Gone by Kelly Clarkson.
Oh, really?
We played that
at Emo Night.
We play that every single time at Emo Night, and it goes off every single time. It was cool, but it was
so pretend. Wow.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I remember this was at the Emo Night in Dallas, and everyone was going nuts. And I'm like, who the hell is covering this?
That's wild.
It almost sounds like a Leo Leapfrog cover.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. We can list off almost every Leo song that we've ever played.
That's true.
Those are always so great.
Yeah.
I just went online to see what is, like, you know, at some music website, timeout.com, I think. I don't know what it is, but they did the best covers of all time. I didn't know that Respect by Aretha Franklin was a cover. It's Otis Redding.
Oh, I'm an idiot.
All this time, right. I forgot about that.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, she definitely one-upped him.
Yeah, she did. Yeah. You're right. When you take a look at some of these songs, you go, that was a cover?
I always forget how many covers Johnny Cash did, because I was trying
Rusty
to remember
Cage.
One. Rusty Cage sounded phenomenal. I totally forgot about this one. He covered Personal Jesus.
Yes.
Depeche Mode. And it sounded so awesome. I'm a fan of when you do a cover, doing it in a completely different genre, whether it's like country to pop or pop to rock or whatever. I love that kind of stuff.
We're forgetting a band that's actually a mega, mega band that's had a really good couple of cover songs that they've done.
Mm.
Super popular band. I mean, this band in rock, they're royalty in rock.
And Metallica?
We know one of the dudes.
Guns N' Roses.
Yeah. They did two covers, Knocking on Heaven's Door and Live and Let Die.
And those are two massive hits. They've done other covers as well, but those two are definitely some big hits for them.
Yeah, and I would argue they're better. I mean, you know, Dylan fans might hate me for the Knocking on Heaven's Door, but I still think
that. How do you feel if you're Bob Dylan? Because Jimi Hendrix covered All Along the Watchtower, and someone, and myself included, would say it's way better than his version.
Yes.
And it's like, okay, I'm writing these great songs, and when other people cover them, everyone says that they do it better.
Yeah. Yeah. I feel like, look, if you're Bob Dylan, if you like the Dylan sound, sure. But if anybody else takes those songs, they're going to make them really good.
You know, it's a great one. I was just looking through that list. It's Hallelujah by Jeff Buckley.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yes. That version's incredible. I actually do like the Leonard Cohen version, which is the original. It's not nearly as beautiful, and it's more gruff because Leonard Cohen's voice is not that, you know, he's got like that, hey, sound like you at 6 a.m. today. Like, he's got raspy voice.
Yeah.
But, Jeff Buckley definitely, I think he definitely topped it.
Yeah, the Buckley version's amazing. And Cohen's version is good, too, but you're right. Buckley really makes it almost a religious experience.
Did you know that Cyndi Lauper's Girls Just Want to Have Fun is a cover?
Oh, who did it before her?
I don't know this person, but Robert Hazard.
Huh. I don't know that either. So there was a dude that sang
that
song?
Can we find that? I'm really
curious.
I always assume, I wouldn't have been surprised if someone said someone else wrote it for her, but it's still her song.
Yeah.
That wouldn't shock me, but I didn't know that it was actually, there was a version before her by Robert Hazard.
Wow. I know that, like Linda Ronstadt, one of her big hits is Poor, Poor, Pitiful Me, and that was Warren Zevon. And I've heard his version, and hers is better. But it's so funny when it's like, you know, you switch genders like that and you go, wow, the whole song is just different when it's sung by somebody of a different gender. Like, you know, it just felt like it was made for Linda, and yet it was written by him and he performed it himself.
Somebody put Satisfaction by Devo on this list, and I disagree. I think that Devo cover of the Rolling Stones song is terrible.
Yeah. What's this now?
This is the Girls Just Want to Have Fun by Robert Hazard.
Oh, I'm curious to hear what it sounds like. Like, what does his voice sound like, right?
Yeah. All right, I'm going to festival.
Oh, I bet it's going to happen.
Wow. Wow.
Sounds like pop punk.
Yeah. Wow, what? Talk about changes to make a hit.
Oh, yeah, there it is. This is a total, like, 80s movie soundtrack song.
Apparently, the song came out in 1979, and it wasn't covered by Cyndi Lauper until 83. Well, just a few years later.
A remix makes so much difference. Boy, does a remix, because that doesn't sound anything really like the song, and she killed it.
Oh, it's definitely, I mean, you definitely notice that song in it. But yeah, you're right. Like, I kind of didn't mind it though.
Now I want to push back on the Devo one, because that was a ska. That was a ska version though. Like Devo was
ska?
Definitely. Yeah, there's a ska
stupid
feeling
version, if you ask me.
Wow.
Wow. Look, I think it's
no. Yeah. That's how it sounds.
I felt like it was more ska, but maybe I'm imagining something. They also did a version of Secret Agent Man, which was also, I think, a really cool, different version of that song.
No, I mean, even they said it's dissected. They dissected the song into a robotic staggered fragment.
Oh, really?
Yeah, dude. That listen to it again and come back to me.
Wow, it's I trash. Really thought it had a ska sound. I'm losing my mind. And I'm noticing Tainted Love by Soft Cell. I didn't know that was a cover either. Yeah. Tainted Love. Oh,
some person by name of Gloria Jones did it.
You know, so many songs from the 80s were covers that we did not know.
Today is the first time I even knew that the Cyndi Lauper song was a cover.
Yeah, the song Always Something There to Remind Me, that was an old song. Yeah, a lot of covers, man. All right, well, we have an important question that has to be answered. It's about Ryan Castle and yoga. What do Ryan Castle and yoga have in common? You're going to find out at 9:52 on The Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW. And now, the Ryan Castle question of the day.
What do Ryan Castle and yoga have in common?
Tight pants.
That's right, Lululemon.
Sweet Heinies.
Oh, yeah.
That was a tax. That was in my thoughts.
Yeah, you sure about that?
Something.
I was doing hot yoga for a while and accidentally had a little fart come out.
Dude, that's why my wife would never take me to yoga with her. She's like, you're going to fart. I know you will.
Oh,
it happens.
You guys both got kicked out because you weren't hot.
You haven't seen me in Lululemons.
No, not lately.
No.
Yeah. So here's what's going on.
I've seen you out of them.
Hey, buddy.
So there are some police in the UK responded to an observatory on Wednesday evening when someone reported seeing a bunch of dead bodies. So the cops are like, wait, what? Apparently, the witness thought there had been a mass murder or some sort of cult ritual killings. But when the police got there, it was just a yoga class. And people were just doing the corpse pose, where a person lays on their back with their arms and legs spread out. So they all looked like they were
dead.
Don't
look dead. They were doing a very good job.
Yeah, they were. Right? This is an advanced class.
The yoga instructor goes,
corpse pose is my favorite.
You guys thought I was a mass murderer, huh? With this man bun and everything? Really? You think I'm a mass murderer, huh?
Well, Sven, they think we're killing each other.
Yeah. They were wrong. Ryan Castle, now he's a mass murderer. He's going to murder your ears with a 12-pack.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW.
Today's podcast was brought to you by Travis Gagne, bankruptcy attorney. Here's another question from a listener. If I file for bankruptcy, do I have to appear in court? That makes me nervous.
Going to court is never something that's easy to do. However, when you file bankruptcy, you usually only have to attend one hearing at the courthouse. Of course, I'll be there with you. And when you go to court, it's not before the judge. It's actually with the trustee or the trustee's attorney. One of the things that's critical in a bankruptcy is that you give your attorney and the court all of your information. You list all of your assets and all of your creditors. That's what we're trading for your discharge, is your true and honest disclosure of your assets and liabilities. And so the court hearing is just usually about a 5-minute deal where you show up and reaffirm and swear that all the information you've given the court and your attorney is correct.
Thanks, Travis. If you have more questions about bankruptcy, you can reach out to Travis anytime at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com. Thanks for listening.